here with master hypnotist Anthony Jacquin from headhacking.com. And Anthony's been talking to us about basically deep trance phenomena and the multiple uses you have for them, both in therapy and, of course, in the thing that he's become very well known for recently in the entertainment world in terms of street hypnosis and really novel uses of street hypnosis. So this is the final seminar in the interview. So welcome back for this, Anthony.
Thanks, Igor. Good to be back.
And today is going to be the pièce de la résistance. This is the moment in which you reveal the magic behind your mayhem, which is, of course, your street hypnosis method. And, you know, I'm kind of excited because we've talked about this before, and I think it's a very simple, it's an ingenious method, it's very simple. I'm a big admirer of systems that have as few working parts as possible so that they're robust, but then they're still elegant in terms of the change they can get. And I think your system definitely fits into that category. Before we actually launch into it, can you give us just a couple of words into how you develop this system, and then we can have a little overview, and then maybe we'll actually look at it step by step.
Yeah, I think I've made fairly clear. You know, I got into this via the kind of Ericksonian approach. So I came into this looking at mastering lots of the language patterns and had more progressive approach, the pacing and leading, the conscious, unconscious dissociation, all of that stuff down. I obviously learned a few of the more direct techniques along the way. And I think, like lots of other people, would sometimes say to myself, well, it can't be that simple. It can't be that easy. When I tested them out, invariably they were effective. But I never really put them down into a system until I was required to. And that relates back to the hypno-survival type stuff that I didn't have time to get into a long-winded, covert For sure. conversational approach. So purely from experience and need, I put together some very basic techniques. When I tested them out, they worked for me. And over the last 3 or 4 years, I've just been refining this approach ever since. I eventually wrote it up in my book, Reality is Plastic. And from the feedback I've got, it is a very good approach, not just for beginners, but I get lots of feedback from hypnotherapists as well, who have just found that going back to basics, recognizing that using rapid inductions, using some of the convincers, basically results in the subject being in the same place, the same state, the same level of suggestibility anyway, is quite refreshing. Not just refreshing, it's almost enlightening sometimes to know that there are pieces of this that you can start to drop or you can start to play with. Right. Now, when I outline the approach, I appreciate that many of the techniques are going to be things people are familiar with but don't necessarily use anymore. And I want to say what I say to students who come on my course, that if you are aware of some of these things, mm-hmm. just be prepared to revisit them and squeeze some value out of them. Just because you might know that, for example, with magnetic fingers, which is something that most people are aware of and some people write off as a playground trick and that kind of thing, they're aware mm-hmm. that there's some physiology involved. Just be prepared to revisit it, because there is so much value that you can squeeze out of these simple techniques. But I'm going to outline the approach in full. Yes, it will be a kind of potted version of what's in my book. I'm going to give you, if you like, the basic recipe that I use in the vast majority of situations. And the other thing that I want people to really pay attention to is that although on the surface this is going to look very simple and direct, I make good use of the language patterns, the more Ericksonian indirect stuff as well, simply as a way of stretching out moments. So rather than it being 2 seconds of silence, I can continue to talk, I can pace and lead, and I can turn this to my advantage by using those kind of language skills. So all I'm saying is, whatever angle you're coming to this from, if you're someone who's into rapid and direct hypnosis already, then, you know, hopefully you'll get some value out of this. But if you've already got the more, not complicated, but the more indirect kind of stuff down, then that is going to be of benefit to you as well.
Excellent. And just to emphasize, I mean, this is something that most people who are in a skill or profession know. Musicians know this. Martial artists definitely know this. The fundamentals, the basics, is where everything is at. If you can do your fundamentals well and polished and in any situation, then everything that seems complex to others is just a reconstitution of the fundamentals. And this is what we'll be looking at today, and I'm very, very excited to do that. And the second thing is, and just to back up what you were saying there again, Anthony, mm-hmm. is the idea that it's not so much the techniques that are important, it's the principles behind the techniques, the mindset that allows you to generate these things. And because the approach is so straightforward and simple, I mean, it's one of those things like Moshe Feldenkrais would call the elusive obvious. Once you hear it, you go, of course, that makes sense. But until you hear it, you go, oh, I don't know if I should do that. It's just like a little bit daunting. And this is the beauty of it. It has to be simple because it's a performance art. And if it's complex, you're going to forget all the moving pieces halfway through. You've got to be able to keep them very clear in your mind so that you're not focusing on the content, you're focusing on the performance, you're focusing on the interaction rather than anything else, right?
Yep, absolutely. I came into martial arts rather late. I'm certainly a grasshopper, knee-high to a grasshopper, but I discovered the wonders of Wing Chun in my mid-30s.
A great system.
And everything you just said there applies to it. It's simple, it's based on solid principles of human anatomy, and you really put some trust sometimes in what are very basic shapes and techniques, and then you have to go and road test them and find out, oh, well, it really does work. So you'll probably find that I make a few kung fu references as I go through because, again, my two passions in life, one's hypnosis and the other's Wing Chun, so I find a lot of crossover.
I suspect this is where we get on so well because I think actually the two disciplines have a lot of common ground because they are both performance disciplines. They are both based on, shall we say, non-compliance. In other words, you're going to go out there and you do things with the real people and you are the one who has to make it work. So there's a lot of areas of overlap there. And I look forward to hearing your Kwai San Chow references as we go through. Now, let's just kick off into the overview of your method. I believe you have 7 steps, which we're going to be looking at in more detail in a moment. But can you just give us an overview so we get a sense of where we're going with this?
Okay, first off, I'm going to talk a little about attitude, this idea of being the hypnotist. That doesn't just mean dress like one, have a goatee beard and swing a watch, although none of those things would necessarily be a bad thing. But I'm going to talk a little bit about attitude and also taking in some of those healthy assumptions, which I learned from being in the therapy room. Trust in your subject's abilities, trust in their creative mind, recognize it doesn't take a special brain to be hypnotized. You're going to build this relationship. So we'll talk about that. Then when we get into the system itself, I'm going to break this down. As I say, it's kind of a potted version of what's in my book, but I'm also going to add in a few things that I've learned myself since the book was written. So I'm going to break it down, first of all, into the approach. By that, I actually mean, how do you walk up to strangers? How do you engineer this into a conversation? How do you engineer situations where you can flex your hypnotic muscles and get started? Because so many people don't even get out the blocks.
Well, exactly.
So we'll talk about that in detail. I will then go into what I call the setup. This isn't tricking anybody or getting one over anybody. This is all about removing the misconceptions, taking control, firing up their imagination. And I'm going to talk about those two things in quite a lot of depth. When it comes down to the actual practice of it, that is probably going to amount to about 3 or 4 lines, okay, of spoken word. So hopefully people will permit me to get into the detail of that. So we've got the approach and the setup. I'll then get into the set piece. Again, this is just a term of mine that applies to what I'm going to do prior to the induction in terms of getting the person used to the ideas I'm presenting, getting their confidence in me and also allowing me to get some belief in them. I'm going to talk about how to make that entertaining so that even if you have to kind of bail out at that point, which sometimes you do, this is still a bit of a numbers game if you want to get into the big phenomena, by then you've given a demonstration. So we'll talk about the set piece in detail. I'll outline the two inductions that I use most often in this situation. I'll probably end up alluding to a few more. But again, it's all about the principles rather than the actual steps of the induction. But I'll outline each step and why I say what I say. Post-induction, I'll talk about what's often called deepening or intensification of the state, stabilizing this relationship that you've got. I'll then explain how we get into the phenomena and why I typically proceed through the phenomena in the way that I do. Again, I'm not dead set on any particular hypnotic scale. It's just in practice, I proceed in a particular fashion. I find it works for me. It doesn't mean you have to. It doesn't mean you have to get amnesia before you get hallucination. But in practice, the vast majority of the time, I work in a particular fashion. So we'll go through that. And we'll then talk about a couple of routines that you can particularly do, favorite routines of mine on the street. I'll outline one that's going to feature on our new DVD, this truth and lie routine. I'll kind of allude to how I use that and a couple of other bits and pieces, I'm sure. And then I'll talk about the induction, if you like, how to wake people up properly, why that's important, and also how you can do that covertly, because a lot of people want to use the hypnosis covertly. I'm a fan of your work. I'm a fan of the whole covert and conversation conversational approach, there is another way of doing covert hypnosis, and that's just to do direct hypnosis and give them amnesia.
I like that.
And if you use that approach, then you don't necessarily want to be doing a very overt wake-up. So we'll talk about ways of managing the wake-up, because it's still important, in my opinion, to wake people up properly. And I'll explain why, and I'll explain a few different ways of doing that.
Fantastic. Well, I know we're going to be in for a roller coaster ride. Just to sum up to everyone, those 9 steps are the attitude, which is, of course, the background to the whole system. If you don't have the attitude, then, well, go home and get it. Then we have the approach. We've got a setup to create the hypnotic context. We've got the set pieces that gets them involved in it and begins the whole entertainment or, you know, education segment. The induction and deepening, which as hypnotists we should be familiar with, but of course you'll be showing us some interesting nuances there.
Yep.
Then the testing, the bit that most people are afraid of, and the routines that come out of it. And finally, of course, ending it, plus, of course, the Jacquin method of covert hypnosis. I love that. Do it directly and give them amnesia. That's fantastic.
Absolutely.
I'm going to do a 20-minute DVD set, just a price, I don't know, $1,000, the new style covert hypnosis. And that's all that's going to be inside it. That's going to be fantastic. Okay, so let's get straight down to business then. Let's look at the attitude, because I think really everything else will be familiar to some degree with people, but the attitude, again, we really need to drill this in, because you don't have the right attitude, everything else falls to pieces, doesn't it?
It seems to. I mean, if you haven't got the attitude, then sure, occasionally you're going to run into someone who's just an absolute grade A subject, and that might give you some confidence. And from that confidence, you may accidentally begin to develop some attitude. Attitude is not all about being authoritarian or overbearing, but my father, Freddie, and it's the context of therapy, made it very clear to me early on that at some point in the hypnotic situation in a therapy room, you need to become the dominant party in that situation. And whether that's through clearly being an expert or knowing about the person's particular problem and a few facts about it, at first you do have to pretend and master it or fake it to make it, whatever you want to call it, but you do really need to be the hypnotist in that situation.
Another friend of mine, Andrew Austin, you've probably heard of, puts it really nicely, where he says a client has to feel that you, the hypnotist, are more powerful, not than him, but than his problem is, because he's suffering from that problem. And if you're not more powerful than the problem, why should he trust you with it in the first place, right?
Absolutely. And part of that's going to be expressed by what you say, but a large part of it's going to be expressed by what you do and how you respond to people's questions about hypnosis and that kind of thing. So first of all, you're not a hypnotist. You're not someone who knows a bit about hypnosis. You are, with a capital T, you are the hypnotist, okay? And everything you do has got to express confidence, congruence, expertise. You have knowledge. And let's face it, for most people, this is secret knowledge. Just using the word hypnosis early on is preferable, because people will fill in that void with all sorts of ideas. They'll probably just believe that if he can do it, he'll probably be able to make me do anything that I want to do. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, as long as you can get rid of their fears. So believe you're the best. Some people will misinterpret that and take it too far. Behave like you can. Behave like your subject is entirely capable of this. And again, I internalized a lot of that stuff early on, even from advice in training trances. I go into therapy and I go into street hypnosis, this kind of impromptu hypnosis, believing my subject is a wonderful subject, that this is going to be a fantastic experience, that they are going to enjoy, that they're going to learn something from. That kind of stuff starts to define my attitude, if you like. The belief that this isn't a special person or a special brain or anything else that's required, that between the two of us, we can make this happen. I absolutely believe that. And that must come across in some way.
And of course, when people start getting into the street hypnosis, one of the big benefits of it, and one of the reasons I recommend that everyone does at least some of it, is that once you start going these interactions, you'll discover how much easier it is than it was inside your mind. In our minds, we make it into this big hullabaloo, like, oh, it's scary, it's crazy, what if this happens, that? Well, actually, once you do it, it's actually a lot easier. And of course, your unconscious mind comes to the rescue as well and says, oh, you know, try this out instead because that might work a little bit better.
Yeah, chipping away at it, just refining your technique constantly. And again, this is the idea, not everyone lives in a big city. Some people in rural areas, some people only have their friends and family available to them, especially in the early days of it. And it's constantly said that your friends and family are harder to hypnotize, or some people say they're impossible to hypnotize. That's not actually true. I appreciate that for them just to take on board an idea that suddenly you know how to hypnotize people, or suddenly you are the hypnotist, might be a little bit tough. But if you sell it to them, if you present it to them in a particular way, that you're going to give them something, let me show you something, let me show you this technique I've learned, it will help you relax, it will help you with that interview, it will just, let me just show you something interesting about the power of your mind, then off you can get into them. And you never know, they may just be a great subject, it may just fall that way. So
right,
you've got to be prepared to get a bit of egg on your face. That's just the way it goes. It still happens to me. I still fail. It may not look like that sometimes when you're just watching YouTube, but you know what it's like. Generally, people aren't posting up videos of their
Watch me fail. Look, yeah, crash and burn again, and here's I'm really, really bad.
But I've got to say, it's very rarely do I come out of a situation where it appears that I failed, because basically I'm in control of this. So I call a stop to things when I want to. I limit my demonstration to what people might describe as waking hypnosis sometimes, because I'm not really getting a good feeling and feedback from the person. But I really don't believe that I walk away from there and saying, well, he can't do it, he can't hypnotize, because I've given the demonstration I wanted to give. And that has helped me so much in terms of getting over the fears of, well, won't I look stupid? And what if they just open their eyes? What if they just pull their hand away? What if it doesn't work? Well, one, you can deal with that by limiting your demonstration if it's not looking good. And I'll talk about the ways that you're going to get those signs. But also recognize it's as much about your subject as it is you. If all else fails, I just tell them it's them, not me.
Go away and leave me to be a powerful hypnotist.
So all I'm saying is, don't ignore friends and family. Try and get them in. Not the people who are going to desperately challenge you, but people who are good to you and care about you and want you to learn new things. Just have a go. Even if you don't get that far, at least you'll have spat the words out and had a go at doing the actions at the same time, so that the next time you're doing it, there's going to be a big portion of your brain that can observe, rather than just worry about whether you got the words in the right order, because it's much more about really meaning what you're saying rather than just getting the words right. So it's good to have a hypno droid in the family. Once you find one, Christmas parties are always much more fun. So
now, just to kind of elaborate on that, for people who are complete novices and they're still afraid of, what if I fail even with my own family, a very simple thing you can do, which is right up the same street that Anthony's just been talking about, is simply ask your family for their help, to help you out. I don't need to hypnotize you. I don't want you to go into a trance. I just need to practice my technique. So you just sit there and pretend for a while, and then I'll do my thing. And that's great on two levels, because number one, chances are they forget they're practicing and they just have this amazing experience anyway. It's one of the first sort of steps into more the covert side of hypnosis, because you're just getting a pretend thing out of them.
Yeah.
And number two, even if they're just pretending and faking it, so what? You're practicing the performance elements of hypnosis, which are so important. And as you're just saying there quite correctly, Anthony, it allows you to hardwire them in, so that then your mind gets freed up from the doing phase into the monitoring to check which way to go or what nuances to add and so on, right?
Absolutely. And in any other performance art, you get a chance to practice hundreds, thousands of times, whether you're playing the guitar or you're doing a card trick. You get
or
to go over
Kung
it.
Fu.
Or Kung Fu, but you're drilling in over and over and over. Because of the fear of failing and the fear of looking stupid or whatever else it happens to be, very often people walk into this hypnotic situation with zero practical behind them, whether they've succeeded or not. So like you say, just get people who are sympathetic to the fact that you want to learn something new and you want to master it. And again, it's a great way of lowering their guard is just to say, look, just pretend I don't want you to be hypnotized to go into a trance. I just want to get through the words and the actions. And that's going to help you a great deal when you're out there in the real world, you know, seizing the opportunities that come your way. Okay?
Absolutely. So that's the attitude then, and I think it's a very healthy attitude. Now, let's say someone's sat at home, they've got their parents in, or their friends, their family, they've either pretended to hypnotize them, and of course got used to the language and the process and so on, or, you know, they've got a little bit more confidence behind them. Now they're going to be saying, right, I'm ready for street hypnosis. I might even go to some other town that I don't know, you know, maybe somewhere big like New York or something like that, and just rip loose for a while.
Yep.
But then they turn up and they're like, you know, New York's a big place. You walk into, you know, Union Station and there's like hundreds of people running around, or you go into a bar and it's a huge bar and there's lots of people. And then they're going to go, all right, what do I do now? Do I hold up a sign saying I'm a hypnotist? Please come over here. How do they get hold of them?
Yeah, well, I've been there. I'm not someone who is naturally the center of the party. I mean, my wife can get into a taxi. I guarantee she'll be speaking to the taxi driver and know plenty about his life by the time she gets home. I lived in London for years. I've worked in bars there. It's easy to get lost in a city,
yes.
especially if you don't know how to spark conversations. This is something I've had to learn. So what I'm going to do first off, in the absence of you having an idea of how best to do that, I'm just going to tell you what I do. And this is exactly what I teach people on my course. It's the first thing I teach people on my course. The ideas are a blend of ideas. They come from performers. In fact, two of them come from quite famous mentalists. These are magicians who do mind reading, that kind of stuff. And another one actually comes from the king of speed seduction himself, Mr. Ross Jeffries. I know, but it's just something. He actually appeared on TV. He was teaching someone on TV something. It's a very, very simple technique. Don't get me wrong. I'm not massively into speed seduction, but I do like the way, as a body of people, as an interest group, it's organized itself. Well, but let's just run through these three tips.
The important thing really is just to realize is that everyone, whether they're walk around magicians or mentalists or even the speed seduction people,
yep,
they have to start conversations. Otherwise, they can't do what they're doing. And we're hypnotists. We have to start conversations.
Absolutely. And I think a big part of speed seduction, despite all the complex and fancy techniques that are out there, the most important bit, in my opinion, is the approach, is how you start the thing. What you really want is to be in a normal conversation
exactly.
after that. Anyway, let's get into this if you're ready. The first tip, it's very, very simple. It comes from a friend of mine. His name's Paul Brook. He's written a series of great books on mentalism. Some of them are kind of just books of effects, and some of them are actually about how best to present yourself. I had a meeting with him one day, and he told me about an effect of his, and I'm not going to tell you how it works, but I'll tell you the effect looks like this. You walk up to a complete stranger on the street. You ask them basically if they've got a wallet. You ask them to remove a note from their wallet. You do not touch it. It's not switched in some magical fashion. They take a note out of their own wallet. They look at it, and you tell them the serial number on that note. Now, that's very impressive. There are various ways of achieving that, okay? However, what was equally impressive to me was the fact that he could walk up to a stranger, ask them to take out their wallet, and ask them to take out some money. So it's like, well,
it's not something that happens usually on the street, is it? Someone comes up to you, give me your wallet. Normally it requires a little bit of adrenaline before that happens, right?
Indeed. So that's really, really simple. I just tell them I'm a performer. Instead, when I use that word performer, I'm immediately given a huge amount of leeway with regard to what I can ask people to do. And I felt this huge penny drop in my mind.
That's a great frame. I mean, it sounds simple, but it's a great realization, isn't it?
It's fantastic. So, if I'm in a bar, I'm on the street, and I want to walk up to a group of people, let's face it, most people on a Saturday daytime or in a Saturday evening in a bar, they're having their regular Saturday. It's not necessarily that exciting. They might be having a laugh and getting drunk and out with their friends and that kind of stuff, but they love something completely different, brand new, to walk into their life. And this is what you're going to do. So the first tip is, when you walk up to a group of people, and again, I'll get into the body language and how you're going to express yourself and that kind of thing. But the first thing I'm going to say is, hi, I'm a performer. I'm a hypnotist. Very, very simple. It does a number of things. But first of all, it opens them up to possibilities. If I was to ask them then, can everyone stand on one leg? I would expect everybody to stand on one leg because I'm a performer.
Part of the entertainment.
There must be something coming after it. Mm-hmm. I love using that line. Yes, it's not covert, but this is infinitely easier if you're open about what you're doing. The moment you use the word hypnotist, that's why I say hypnotist as well as performer, you've already fired up that little neurological path, that little pattern in their mind of what it is to be hypnotized, of what might happen.
The most powerful hypnotic induction is the words, I'm a hypnotist. And at that point, expectations and years of built-up associations suddenly get released, right?
Absolutely. And if you say, I'm a performer, if there's a camera there, I'll say we're filming in here tonight, we're having some fun in here tonight, that kind of thing, you're halfway there already. So that's the first tip. Very, very simple.
I think it's a very elegant introduction.
The second one comes from one of the greatest gentleman of mentalism of all. His name is Doc Hilford, and he's been on the scene for a long, long time. He actually trained in hypnosis with Orman McGill many years ago, and he's a fantastic guy. He came over to the UK. I got to meet him, and I got to see his system. It's called a cold psychological reading system. You don't present yourself as a psychic, but it allows you to walk up to a complete stranger and certainly give the impression that you know everything about them. Now, the one thing, again, I'm not going to tell you how it all works. It's called System 88. You can check it out for yourself. But his opener is to walk up to someone, and he says this to them. He says, I could ask you 5 questions and know everything about you, tell you everything about you. Okay, now, this does a number of things. First off, without even telling them who you are, this introduces who you are. Oh, right, you're some sort of mind reader or psychic, or, you know, it introduces the playground. If they carry on talking to you, they've already got an idea of where this is going to go. It's going to be fun, but they've already got an idea that you might be able to do something that they don't know anything about at this point in time. Okay, so it introduces who you are, and it opens up this playground. Most importantly of all, and I don't want to use this phrase because it's far too NLP for me, but it elicits a response. Okay, when you say that to somebody, they do not have a choice. They have to respond. The response could be, get out of here. It could be, go on then. It could be, what do you mean? It doesn't matter. You're now into conversation.
Right.
Okay, you've now got a response, and you've got something you can bounce off and you can get back into it.
Can I just pause you there? Because I think you've just hit on something really, really important. Whether you're doing covert hypnosis or you're doing it overtly in terms of street hypnosis, this idea is actually so easy for people to miss, but actually is the bit that makes everything easy. Conversations are interactions. Street hypnosis requires an interaction. Of course, conversation hypnosis requires a conversation for it to fit in. And what you're saying is the starting point has got to be a really simple way of basically poking them to see how they'll poke back. Are they going to poke back aggressively, kindly, open-mindedly, closed-mindedly, challenging, and so on? And that tells you, this is the way the conversation's going. This is how I need to alter my performance to fit it, right?
Absolutely. It's the munsell. It's the asking hand. You're out there. It's like, I'm just going to give them a little touch. Or if they move forward, I feel that touch again. I'm ready to go. And it's exactly the same with this. And as I say, they're the principles that I try and include. Whatever I say, however people structure this, the principles are, it lets them know who you are. It arranges the playground. It sorts out that if they carry on speaking to you, they've got a pretty good idea what might happen. And it also elicits a response. And by then, we've got something that we can kind of build upon. Even though it's a tiny little kernel, right, we've already got something we can build upon. So
now, there's something else I know you do, and it covers something which I always found a little bit shocking from another performance art general, the table hopping magicians. Yeah. And you know, some of them do a phenomenal job. I'm just so charmed by them. And you know you've got a good magician on your hands, because when he does a trick, you don't ask him, how do you do that? You just sit back and go, I'm glad you did that.
Yeah.
But then there's a whole bunch of table hopping magicians who, I'm not gonna criticize them too much, because they're just starting out and they're learning the ropes and so on. But they try and copy these other performers, and they do such a rough imitation. What they end up doing is they insult their audience. They'll come in and they'll make a joke about someone's jewelry. Says, "Oh, can I borrow your watch, sir? Oh, look, it's a fake Rolex. Ha ha! If it breaks, it won't cost me very much." And what they're doing is they're being very disrespectful to their audience.
Well, it's not a two-way interaction. And sometimes, there's a wonderful book called Presence. I don't know if you've heard of Patsy Rodenberg. You should check it out. You'd love it. She's a voice coach. She's worked with lots and lots of famous people, but she wrote a book called Presence. She sat there watching hundreds of actors, some of whom were technically perfect, but she'd feel nothing. She'd feel no connection, or she'd even feel pushed in the other direction. It's a very simple idea to get your head around. In fact, I was using it before I'd even read the book. A friend told me about it, and a penny just dropped, and it was like, wow. But she talks about 3 circles. If you're in first circle, it's very inwards. You're listening to that voice in your head. All the energy is kind of coming into you. If you're third circle person, you're that pushy, outward. There's time to be in first and third circle. Both those circles very one way. Second circle is where you're actively listening, where you're relaxed physically, where you're able to actually give and receive information in this communication. And I think just sometimes through nerves, people either dive into that first or third circle. It's a superb book. I know you'd enjoy reading that.
It sounds awesome.
It is very good indeed. So, and the third tip, if I can just get onto this, mm-hmm. the third tip, as I said, comes from Ross Jeffries. Now, there'll be people listening who don't even know what speed seduction is. So speed seduction is essentially the art of picking up, well, mainly women, but I guess picking up people of the opposite sex, or not necessarily the opposite sex, but just picking up people you want to pick up and introducing yourself to people and mastering that as a skill, looking at it as a bunch of techniques that can be learned. Okay. Now, he was featured in a program with a British guy called Louis Theroux. He makes programs that appear to be an interview, appear to be a sort of documentary, fly on the wall style interview. But what he's mastered is the art of allowing people to dig a great big pit for themselves and watch, them, watch them and watch them walk into it. And it's a very particular manner that he manages to hold, where the last thing he'd want to appear is rude. He's a bit like a sort of bumbling, an intelligent but bumbling kind of fool, but he just allows people to fall into the trap. And he did a series called Weird Weekends. I believe you can watch this one online somewhere. And one of them was about hypnosis. And it was that bad, it made me want to get out of the business. It was just like, my God.
Yeah, is that, I remember that.
It was like, is that what I'm doing? But anyway, he interviewed Ross Jeffries, who's been the sort of self-proclaimed master of speed seduction since the mid-70s. He's a big NLP guy. He knows his stuff. I don't deny that. And that's his thing. And he does it very well, and he teaches it very well. And I just was waiting for him to fall into a self-made trap. Now, Louis asked him for some tips. He saw an attractive girl on the other side of the road, and he was like, well, how do I speak to her? You know, I feel nervous. How do I go up to her? And he said, just remember this. Just use this. C-I-Q. C-I-Q standing for compliment, introduction, question. Okay? Use them in that order. Again, this made a lot of sense to me. So this is what I do now. When I walk up to an individual, when I walk up to a group of people sitting in a bar, I will give them a compliment. And it's not, as long as it's not something sleazy, then it doesn't really matter what it is. So you can say, hi, it looks like this is where the party's at. You guys look like you're having some fun. You two gentlemen look like you're an intelligent couple of guys. Anything, just say something. You look like a creative person. Anything at all, give them a compliment. Do not pause and wait for any feedback. Just give them a compliment and then introduce yourself.
Can I just pause you there for a second?
Yeah.
Because, again, you just said something which is very, very important when it comes to the art of starting conversations. The source of it is actually almost irrelevant, because what we're talking about here is how to create genuine, good, solid conversations and interactions going. And the key piece you just mentioned there was you have some kind of starter, whether it's your opener is, hi, my name's so-and-so, or your opener is, hey, you guys look like you're having fun. The key thing is you don't wait for them to react to that. This is one of the big mistakes that people make. They sit there, they pretend it's a normal conversation with someone they already know. And what happens, you say, how are you? They say, how are you? And then you wait for them to engage you in conversation and carry it on. Well, strangers won't do this. They feel just as shy and inhibited as you are. So the way I like to think of it is, you know, if you're going to be polite, you're going to carry the conversation until they kind of warmed up enough to be able to hold their own in the conversation rather than shriveling up and becoming a shrinking violet.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, this is probably the first thing I do. So I'm going to give a compliment. It doesn't matter what it is. I will find something that I can say. It could just be about them as a group. It could be about their energy. It could be they're having fun. It could be they look like a laugh or whatever. I'm going to give that compliment, and then I'm going to go for the I for introduction, which I've already explained. You guys look like you're having fun. I'm Anthony. I'm a performer. I'm a hypnotist. That's it. That's my introduction done. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to ask a question. People will think long and hard, what's the perfect question? The truth is, it doesn't really matter. I just need to get that response going. So I'm going to say, it looks like this is where the fun is. I'm Anthony. I'm a performer. I'm a hypnotist. Can I show you something interesting? Have any of you been hypnotized before? It doesn't really matter. Typically, I will say something like that. Can I show you something interesting? Has anyone here been hypnotized before? I mean, if you can ask that question early on and two hands go up, then it's like, great, you've already kind of got
you know who to take, right? It's like, you guys are my stars.
You've got to start. And can I just show you something interesting? Because you've given a compliment, most people have read a bit about Cialdini and the thought of people owing you something when you give them something that's no different with a compliment. So give a compliment, introduce yourself in such a way that you set the agenda, you let them know who you are, and that's done with that line, and then ask a question, and now we're ready to go. So verbally, that is my approach. Okay. The other thing I want to do, and I'm going to break this down in the later steps, is I want to become physically, I want to kind of get into this group. Now, at this early stage, this very opening stage, it is vitally important that everything that your body language is saying is open. You need to be not overbearing, but you need to be bigger than the group. And I'm not the biggest guy on the planet. So you need your elbows bent, your hands out in front of you, hands open, palms up. It's all very Tony Blair, I know, but it's kind of like just be open, just allow people in. Stand there and look at everyone, make lots of eye contact. Occasionally, I'll just say, what's your name? And I'll just start to get to know people right then just to pull them in. The other thing is very often in a group, especially if you're doing this in bars where people are in a kind of party mood, there will always be someone who immediately wants to kind of be the person who's on top. Yeah, me. Yeah. And he's jumping up. Now, for the fledgling hypnotist, again, it's very easy just to fall into the trap of immediately focusing on them, thinking, well, they're giving me some attention, therefore I'll focus on them. But their personality, their persona may be so much bigger than yours at this moment. They may be the joker of the pack or whatever, that they're not necessarily going to be the best subject. They might be the best subject, but if you immediately crouch down and focus on them and speak to them, you're going to lose the rest of the group. So at this point, if someone does that, I would just make a joke. You know, I know you're keen. I know you're ready to be hypnotized. It gets a little of a laugh. Everyone's shoulders relax a little bit, but I'm going to continue to speak to the group because when I get into the set piece and also just setting things up, I want as many people to hear the setup as possible. And I want as many people to take part in the set piece exercises as possible because I want everything to work in my favor. Yes, it may turn out they're the true star of the group, but at this point, you don't know that. So just because it might be comfortable to think, oh, someone's spoken to me, just keep it open.
Can I just pause you there? Because I think you've just come up with a whole gold mine of stuff here. And I know we're spending a lot of time on the approach, but really, in my opinion, this is really the get-go. Like in a therapy session, the most important thing is how do you greet your client? Because everything else will devolve from that. And in this sense, you've got exactly the same thing going on. For example, with the joke of the pack that you're talking about, one of the biggest problems, this is true of stage hypnotists and in street hypnotists as well, and I'm sure you've experienced this, and in fact, made the mistake, same mistake I have, is if you focus on this person too quickly, they are now in control of the interaction and not you. Yep. So they'll be a great hypnotist, but not you. You can't hypnotize the person until they're following your steps rather than them shooting little wisecracks on the side and deciding which direction to go in and so on.
Exactly. And as I said, there is a moment where you're going to become the dominant party. You don't have to go in like a steamroller, but at some point you're aiming to have, at least appear to be, absolute physical and mental control. You're the director of those two things. And sometimes you have to kind of earn that, even though it doesn't necessarily take very long. And if that person is demanding that they're going to be on top, yeah, they probably are at this point. So you need to let them kind of have their say, but you need to carry on including everyone else. You'll find that that allows other people to say, no, hear him out. No, shut up a minute. They'll do it for you. Right. They will take control of things for you.
You need to have the rapport of the whole group. Otherwise, you lose the whole group and then you end up just doing a one-on-one anyway.
Yep.
The other thing is, and I think you mentioned just then and a few times before as well, the idea of you don't want to bulldozer your group and at the same time, you don't want to approach like a meek mouse. The rule of thumb I have in my head, and I'm sure you do something very similar, Anthony, is you know, every group has a kind of an emotional vibe. If you think of like emotions being at energy levels, some are at high energy, they're the big party crowd. Some are at lower energy, like your granny's drinking tea and having a chat. And what you want to be doing when you enter that group is you want to have just a little bit more energy than they have. So if you have less energy, there's no reason for them to talk to you because you're sucking away entertainment value from them. If you have too much energy, you'll blow a fuse because they don't know how to deal with you. They'll get scared. They'll get inhibited. But if it's just a little bit more energy than they have, they get kind of like, wow, my day's about to become better than it already was. And at that point, you have this unconscious opening saying, okay, I'll give you a moment. Show me what you've got, right?
Absolutely. And that's kind of what I mean by being bigger than the group. I don't just mean being physically open and prepared to open yourself up in that way. I mean what you say there. You know, it is about just being like them and a little bit more. And I often say that to people, just be yourself, but a bit more.
Anyone who hasn't done any performance art, especially street hypnosis, may not appreciate it as fully. But once you start getting used to it, you'll know exactly what we mean when we talk about this.
Yeah, when I first did a few bits of TV and it was a piece to camera and it was very much about me being me. Just be yourself, but bigger. Be yourself, but a little bit more. I didn't quite understand it at first, but that's exactly what it is. Being your best self is probably the best way of putting it. Thank you. stage hypnotist, does their job with posters and advertising and promotion and all that kind of stuff. And then there's a bit of an intro where they tell everyone that they're in safe hands and they're an expert. The therapy room, you've got your certificates and you've had an advert and they've had a referral and you tell all the fibs about the subject remaining in control and they'll be aware of everything and all this kind of stuff. In impromptu hypnosis, you've got to achieve this in a couple of sentences. You've got to achieve this in a few seconds. But the objectives of this setup are to remove fear, if there is any, to get rid of their misconceptions as quickly as you can. And you can just spit this stuff out very, very quickly. Build some expectancy in the situation. As I said before, when I'm on stage, I'll just point to the chairs and say, in a while from now, a number of you will be sitting up here in a deep state of hypnosis. But just increase their expectancy. Saying you're a hypnotist very proudly does that. Firing up their imagination, selling it to them, letting them know that they're going to benefit from this. It's going to be a great experience. You're going to love this. Most importantly, this is where I'm going to go from being an equal to kind of really being a dominant party. I want to take control of the group. And there's very, very simple ways of doing that, which I'm sure a few people are familiar with, but we're just going to run through it. The common fears, and you'll hear this stuff if you get out there and start hypnotizing people, you'll see people say, and in fact, we had this. I was out with a performer just this week teaching him some hypnosis in a bar. It was a group of lads, very loud, kind of dancing around, even though the bar was half empty. And we mentioned hypnosis. And there was one guy who immediately backed off and was just like, well, no, there's no way I'd do that. You can make me do things. You could make me do this. You could make me do that. Later on in the evening, when he'd seen a friend of his have a bit of a bash at it, this guy just jumped up and just said, I want some of that. Because he had fear. But to get rid of his... Yeah, sorry, go on.
You, what you're saying there, because I think this is a question that comes up time after time after time. And people are asking, what are the magic words to prevent that from happening? And in my opinion, and I'd be welcoming your opinion on this as well, is there's no such thing as magic words. Because if they're really that afraid, saying, it's okay, it's not going to be like that, won't really help. Your attitude will do a lot to help, but the words themselves won't necessarily sway them that much. But as soon as you do someone else, in other words, you give them a demonstration, an experience of how respectfully you've treated someone else, how much fun it can be for them, how they've maybe accessed some powerful experience and really enjoyed it or learned from it, then in my opinion, or my experience, should I say, most people, other than if they have some kind of religious issue around it because they misconceived it, most people will just suddenly warm up and go, wow, that's amazing. Do you think I could have a go? And sometimes they even say, can I have a go in private? Because I don't want my friends to see. But it's almost never that I come across a person who still doesn't want to have a go after seeing someone else having a wonderful time with us.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, I will, don't get me wrong, I will say the words. If someone says, oh, can I get stuck in a trance? Oh, you'll make me look stupid. Or you're not going to make me take my trousers off, are you? Or whatever else it happens to be. I will just rebuff that immediately. I will just say, of course you can't get stuck in a trance. I'm not that kind of hypnotist. I'm going to show you something that will be interesting to you. Just rebuff those things, almost like they're absurd. I'm just here to have fun. I'm going to show you something interesting, that kind of thing. I often call this your elevator pitch. It's that idea you're stuck in a lift with Bill Gates or Richard Branson. You've got a fantastic idea. You've only got 30 seconds to sell it. I'm going to tell them I'm a hypnotist and I'm just going to get into it. I want to try something with all of you. We're going to have some fun. This is going to be interesting. Understand that you'll learn something new, or I want as many of you to take part in this as possible. No, you're not going to be asleep. If someone says, oh, no, is it being asleep? No, you're not going to be asleep. If someone says, I'm a control freak, I'll say, well, I'm going to show you how to have even more control over your own mind. I'm just going to keep giving it to them. This is going to be positive. This is going to be good. This is going to be fun. I'm going to keep it upbeat. You don't really need to get into a 20-minute explanation or even a 20-second explanation of why it works, how it works, what it is. Say, this is just about your own mind. It's going to get you in touch with your own creative mind. Say whatever you've got to say. Again, don't get hung up on theory. Just say what you've got to say. The other thing...
Can I just pull you there again? Just I want to emphasize something that you again mentioned there, which is up to this point, we've gone the approach, we've gone the setup being like a little mini intro into hypnosis. We're talking literally 1 or 2 minutes at best. We're not talking 5 minutes. We're not talking 10 minutes. We're definitely not talking half an hour. We're just talking about 1 to 2 minutes at best, right?
Within 1 to 2 minutes, I want to be into my set piece, if not most of the way through it. The other thing that I'm going to do, and again, it's a kind of well-known tip amongst performers on stage, but not necessarily off stage, is to begin to take physical control and to get the whole compliance thing going. I'm not a believer that all hypnosis is just social compliance. However, at this early stage, this again is another little poke. It's another little touch. Mm. It's going to get me a nice kind of light going on of whether they're responding to me. So if I'm going to deal with an individual, let's say one person emerges from the group and says, yeah, okay, I'm up for this, then I will always, always request some adjustment. Can you just sit here?
Yes.
Could you just move your chair? Could you just put your feet together? I'm going to use that conversational posture. I'm going to use would you? I'm going to use can you? And you're going to see that this carries in right into the inductions. I'm going to continue to use that idea of can you and would you. It doesn't sound like a command, but generally it's just interpreted as an instruction and they will slot right into place. Can you just turn your seat to one side slightly? Can you just put your feet on the floor? That kind of thing. Can you just put your hands on your lap? Just look at me. And I'm going to try and get out three or four of those kind of things. What this also does by asking someone to move their chair, it allows me to get them in the kind of optimum position for me in terms of performance and other people being able to see them. It allows me to get them into the optimum position for me to actually do my induction and run my techniques. So it's just a little bit of gentle nudging to get the person exactly where I want them. But it's also going to allow them the comfort. Cesar Millan's touring at the moment in the UK. It's going to allow them the comfort of knowing who is in control. People like to know who is in control and like to feel the hands they are allowing themselves to be put into are safe hands. So simple stuff, even if they're standing on the X on my stage, they're going to be shifted to one side. It's as simple as that. People have been doing it for years, but it's very useful.
And just to emphasize what Anthony's saying here, don't skip this step. It may seem trivial to get someone to move a shoulder or come an inch forward or something like that, but you're doing two very, very important things here. Number one is you're constantly testing. If you have trouble shifting them from, you know, just an inch across, well then, how likely is it going to be they're going to follow your instructions to go into trance and so on? Not that likely. Number two, you're already creating the process of the interaction. You're setting the theme, which is, I tell, it's simple Simon, basically.
Yep.
I say, you do. I say, you do. I say, you do. But you don't actually necessarily say it that way. You're just getting them into that habit. And by the time you're doing, mental experiences, they'll do those mental experiences without realizing that that's the chain that they've got used to. It's kind of like a indirect yes set, isn't it?
It is a yes set as far as I'm concerned. I mean, I use the same language. But again, because a yes set is so simple to comprehend when you read it in a book, it's also one of those steps that people just drop.
Yes.
They just miss it.
And it's a big mistake to drop.
It is. And you said it there. This is a test. This is a gentle kind of soft test. As far as I'm concerned, I believe you can give suggestions to people and they'll take those suggestions on board without any of the formalities of hypnosis. So I treat every utterance I make as a suggestion. And by using the language of a yes set, the can you, would you, just place your feet on the floor, absolutely that person knows I'm an expert. They start to get interested. By the end of the setup, I'm going to be kind of animated and excited for them, but I want them to be fascinated, not just with the idea of getting hypnotized. I want them to be fascinated with me, if you like. And again, at this point, this is one other point. People often say, I'm sure you've had this hundreds of times, people will ask you, how do you spot who's going to be a good subject? Now, I probably could theorize on that, but basically the way I do it in these kind of situations is I'm looking for the person who is fixated on me. Male, female, doesn't make a difference. I'm looking for the person who has responded to my approach by sitting still, by looking at me, someone who, in a way, already looks entranced because they are listening to every word I am saying. And understand, that person can still put out the questions, the fears, and all that kind of stuff. But if they're locked on, then that is the biggest tick in the box for me. That's who I am likely to gravitate towards. It's a simple thing, but it's the look, and you can't really recognize it until you've been doing this for a while. But once you see it, you will see it over and over and over and over.
The simplest way to describe it in my terms, and please feel free to add to this, Anthony, if you wish to, it's the look you end up getting is basically, you know you have 100% of their attention. Most people, when you talk to them, their eyes will shift. You can tell that they've just had a thought. Maybe they just thought about their dinner or something they're doing next week. And maybe they even ask something, they'll have another thought and they'll go off on that. You can see them, when you look at them, you can see how their mind is bouncing around, and usually their eyes are bouncing around with it, because as a rule, your eyes will mirror your mental state.
Yep.
Then there's some people who suddenly they come totally laser focused. You can see it when they're reading a book or writing a report, or sometimes even watching TV. Everything else fades away. when you get that look, like you are the TV set, like you are this fascinating book, or even when they see like a cute little puppy, and for that those 2 minutes that they're playing and petting the puppy, they just totally focus on that puppy.
Yep.
If you are that puppy and they look at you in the same way, you're on a winner.
Absolutely. It's one of the first videos I put up on YouTube. It's very raw. It's not particularly special, other than the fact you'll see this in process. I've approached a bunch of girls. They're out doing some shopping. There's five girls sitting on a bench, and it's on my A-N-T-O-N-M-E-S, Anton Mez. It's on a YouTube channel. You'll see the two on the end are massively excited. They're jumping around. They're having fun. I ask them to place their feet on the floor. They look down the street to see who's watching them. To be honest, I'd already written them off at that point. They then cross their legs. I've doubly written them off right now. There's one girl on the end. She's quiet. She's still. She's there, as far as I'm concerned, already. And you'll see when I look along the row, bang, that's the one I go for, and she's capable of the whole thing. So we've been talking for an hour. You're now about 30 seconds into your hypnotic encounter.
Just to emphasize a point here, everyone is always looking for what's the induction you do, what is the magic word to say here, but yeah. Actually they're looking in the wrong place. The reason we spent an hour on all this setup stuff is because this is where the magic is really at. This is one which would be important for people to understand. You get this, all this stuff up right, the rest is virtually mechanical. If you get this stuff wrong, then you have all kinds of things popping up later on that may be more challenging to deal with, right?
Absolutely, absolutely.
So let's get into the next step, the set piece then.
Okay, the set piece. Now, first of all, there are so many different exercises you can use in a set piece. I'm going to talk through two that are probably the most well-known exercises of so-called waking hypnosis, sometimes referred to as suggestibility tests. Both of those terms sell them massively short, in my opinion. There's so much more you can achieve. I want to emphasize these two, not just because people know them, but because they get written off. A lot of people think, well, I'll just go for the motions there, and don't really know how much value they have. So I'm going to talk about good old magnetic fingers and magnetic hands. Okay, there's many, many more things you can do.
The absolute classics, though.
Absolutely. But again, back in the real world, this is what I do. Once I've done my setup, I want everyone involved doing magnetic fingers. It's easy to do. Now, a set piece, there's a number of things I'm trying to achieve. First off, I want you to think of these exercises not just as tests, but you can think of it that way. I'd never present it as a test. I'd never use the word test. But yes, I am getting a gauge of not just whether their fingers come together, because they're useless as tests, because 99.9% of people's fingers are going to come together, mm-hmm. right? So they don't differentiate. But they are a gauge, an extension of what we've already spoken about. How good, how willing, how able are these people to follow instructions? They are going to give me an opportunity to observe the people taking my instructions, taking my directions. They're going to give me an opportunity to gather information. Some people are going to already begin to exhibit some of the classic signs of hypnosis, whether it's their face flattening out, the color changing, the eyes fluttering, REM movement. I am observing at this point. I'm not just going through the motions. I'm assessing their suitability. It gives the subjects an opportunity, before we actually get to the real stuff, the big induction, it gives the subjects an opportunity to experience a little bit of what's going to happen, to experience the power of suggestion and influence, to experience a little bit about their own ability to cooperate, because I will often say that line in my setup. I'll say, look, hypnosis requires cooperation. If I ask you to imagine something, do your best to imagine it. If I ask you to get a sense of something, feel something, I want you to do your best to feel it. Are you ready? Good. That kind of thing. It gives them a little experience. And if you've done magnetic fingers with a group of people, you're going to hear, oh, God, that's weird, isn't it? I did it to a guy today at work. He's 48 years old. His kid probably does this in the playground, to be honest. But his face when I did it was just like, oh, my God, a massive grin, a massive smile. And it wasn't because he was remembering doing this as a child in the playground. It was because he was absolutely in awe of the fact that his fingers had moved together.
Right.
And I'll talk.
And this is important because you're setting up all this stuff in the framework of I'm a hypnotist. This is something hypnotic, mesmerizing, different. So something that could seem like a kid's trick will seem really that much more significant to a normal person, because it's done by a hypnotist, so it has to be more meaningful.
Exactly. So it fires up their imagination, which we've spoken about already. It focuses their attention if you do this properly. It allows you to manage that focus, because if they're looking around, darting their eyes around the place, you can put in that suggestion, look at that gap between your fingers, stare at that gap. If they're not doing it, they're probably not going to come with you. So it allows you to manage their attention. It genuinely focuses their attention and builds this expectation that, well, is this it? Or am I about to be hypnotized? Or, God, this is happening now. What's the next step going to be? It fires up that expectation. However, the most important value, as far as I'm concerned, in this set piece is that it can just become the induction. And mm-hmm. you're going to learn to make the call of, right, you can go right from magnetic fingers to sleep, bang, and they're out as quickly as that. And so recognize that in the mind of the layperson, hypnosis happens like this. I'm a hypnotist. Sleep, do this. There isn't right. a great deal more process to it.
Which is good, because it makes our life easier, doesn't it? Because we're just going to conform to the expectation.
It does. But I think because so many people get into this via NLP and via the Ericksonian approach, again, which I know has huge amounts of value and I use myself, they forget that for decades, this was all about being direct authoritarian and just going for it. You need to have that in the bag. You need to be able to just proceed mm-hmm. and use that word sleep with confidence. I had hypnotized over 3,000 people before I used the word sleep, because it seemed ridiculous to me to say the word sleep. The moment I started saying, I've never stopped saying it since, because people know what you mean. They might not think they do, but they do. They know that that's the cue. That's when you go. That's when it happens.
So just to emphasize what you're saying there, you know, even those of us who are more, shall we say, inclined to the Ericksonian approach, which I know you are, by the way, as well, Anthony.
Yep. Yes, indeed.
When you watch Erickson's work, the key thing to realize is Erickson was trained in exactly this kind of hypnosis that Anthony's describing right now. He used to work with a man called Clark Hull during the famous 99 experiments in hypnosis back in the 1920s or 30s. Mm-hmm. And his style evolved from there. Now, when you see Erickson doing all these crazy things, people go, this is amazing. He's getting people to hallucinate stuff, and he's getting people to live a week in trance without realizing that they've been doing different things. He's coming from a place where he's already done everything Anthony's talking about right now, but then he's layered in these other suggestions, the indirect versions of things, as, shall we say, icing on the cake to obscure things a little bit more, to add a little bit more charm and magic on the whole thing, to make it a little less easy to penetrate it consciously.
Yep.
But his mindset is still the same mindset of a dire hypnotist. His cues, the things he's looking for in the client, are still the same cues as a hypnotist. His intent is still that intention of, this is absolutely going to happen, and all that comes from direct hypnosis. If you don't have the guts to do direct hypnosis, then your indirect hypnosis will be a lot weaker for it. And I don't mean weak in terms of you can't control people and so on. I mean, it'll be ineffective, because there is something in what you're suggesting that just doesn't quite match the reality.
Indeed. And I got an email just yesterday from a guy. He's an 80-year-old magician. He emailed me and said he's got the Manchurian approach, my set on hypnosis. He hasn't actually done any since the 50s. He sent me an email. He said, in 1947, I went to see Ralph Slater, the most famous stage hypnotist of his day. Mm-hmm. I saw him do the handshake induction numerous times. He was known as being the fastest hypnotist throughout Europe. I dug a little deeper into it. Erickson based a huge amount of his technique at that point in time by observing Ralph Slater and other stage hypnotists. I appreciate to sell it back into the medical profession. He eventually had less positive things to say. He had to move away from it. But the fact is, you know, he owed a great deal to the direct approach. So we're getting into it now. We've done our intro. I don't hang around. I don't wait for any conversation. I'd say, okay, let's try something. I want all of you. Can you place your feet on the floor? Can you put your hands on your lap? Can you? You know, do it as long as you want to. Now, just look at me, and I'm going to get into magnetic fingers, and I'll talk you through how I do it. I'm going to give you my exact script. I don't rehearse this one, and I do magnetic fingers with the eyes open, and I link the fingers touching with another very permissive line of, when they touch, can you allow your eyes to close? So it's going to run exactly like this, exactly as this timing. Okay, let's try something, a simple exercise just to fire up your power of concentration. I'd like you to place your hands out in front of you like this. Now, can you clasp your hands together, nice and tight, palms together, thumbs crossed, bend your elbows like you're making a desperate prayer. You can make one while there if you like. Now put your first fingers up, your index fingers, straight up about an inch apart, and look at the gap between your fingers, because in a moment they will come together and touch, like magnets being pulled together closer and closer. That's right. And when they touch, just allow your eyes to close. Bang, I'm done. That's it. Now, there's a few little things in there. I know people know how to do this already. Firstly, I've read other people's versions of this where they say, squeeze your hands together and try and keep your fingers apart, which kind of gives the game away, in my opinion. There is physiology involved. Basically, when your hands are tense, your fingers are going to come together anyway. So I just set the hands up nice and tight, and then they raise the index fingers, so they're kind of spring-loaded. Mm-hmm. I say, look at the gap between your fingers. And if they look at me, I just say, don't look at me. Look at the gap between your fingers. And bearing in mind that some people will get their fingers together in about 2 seconds. Other people, you're going to have to use suggestion to make this happen. Mm-hmm. The very next utterance I make after look at the gap between your fingers is to state the outcome. Because in a moment, they will come together and touch. And then I'm just going to use however long it takes. I'm just going to keep talking. I'm going to basically sell the same idea in 4, 5, 6 different ways. That's right, like magnets. They're getting closer and closer. They're starting to go. That's right, closer and closer, millimeters to go. I'm saying the same thing.
Can I just pause you there? Because I think you just came up with a very, very important element here, which is, and this happens time after time, especially when you're doing this like an impromptu settings, fingers will come together very quickly. And if you wait too long giving instructions, they may have succeeded before they know what it should mean. So you have to give them that meaning right up front. Hence, really dive in quickly and say, those fingers will come together. And when that happens, just close your eyes and go into a trance or whatever. So that it's already there in their expectation right at the start, and then the rest just reinforces it. If you wait too long, then you can actually miss the moments with some of the best responders, right?
Yeah, and again, I'd say with magnetic fingers, it may be 90% a physical reason why they come together. But that 10%, the portion that's left, you've got to manage with suggestion to get this ideomotor movement going, because essentially that's what it is. In a moment, they will come together and touch. The idea, that seed is now planted in their brain. Their body has to begin to respond to it. Literally, you've got to get your timing right. Just as they're about to touch, you literally say millimeters to go. And when they touch, you can allow your eyes to close. I don't say close your eyes. If you want to be strong about it, you can. You can say, and when they touch, your eyes will close. If I was on stage, I might put it that way, and then bang, I'd expect them to close. If they didn't close and I was being that direct, and your eyes will close, I would just say, close your eyes immediately afterwards anyway. But again, there's another little soft touch there, another little poke to see if that suggestion is taking effect. I will do that. I'll get them to take a nice deep breath in just to breathe out, and there's various ways I will go from there. One way is I'll just say, excellent. Now just open your eyes. Great, that shows me you can concentrate. You can pull your hands apart. Another little tiny little tip. The fact is their hands are together. I want to own them. I want to own their hands. So I'm going to give them permission to pull their hands apart rather than wait until they pull them apart. I'll just say, that's right, you can pull your hands apart now. As if it sounds like a throwaway comment, but I've given them permission to do it.
Right. And the other thing is it's another indirect test, because if they pull their hands apart too quickly, that's fine. It's not necessarily a bad thing, but that's one experience. But if they're sitting there with their hands pressed desperately together, until you say you can now open your hands, and then they release the hands. Again, it's a test to show compliance. It's a test to show that they're absolutely following your instructions to the letter, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I'm looking for, following my instructions to the letter. Let me quickly go through a couple of other ways that I'm going to use this once they come together and touch. Sometimes I will use magnetic fingers and magnetic hands as inductions, even though I'm going to do a subsequent induction. So if you like, it becomes kind of fractionation without all the eyes open, eyes closed stuff. Mm-hmm. They're millimeters away. I say, that's right, they're about to touch. When they touch, allow your eyes to close and sleep. Just relax, go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. So when they touch, I will gesture that I want their eyes closed. I'll tap their head on the back. I don't push it forward or yank their head or any of that stuff. I'll just tap their head, and some people will just go. Some people are not there yet but will comply and just tap their head forward. I don't necessarily test my work at this point. I'm just going to say, that's right, take a nice deep breath in, breathe out. And when I say one, two, wide awake, your eyes will open. Excellent. That shows me you can concentrate. I won't explain it. I won't say, ha, you were hypnotized there or you weren't. I will just move on to the next exercise.
So let me just add something to what you're saying there, which is very, very smart, and I want to just pull out for people to really realize this, which is when you're saying, let's say, close your eyes now, sleep deeper, 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 deeper. Well, first of all, you of course realize the secret of an instant induction is not the induction, which is a no-brainer. It's what you do right afterwards, the going, carrying on with the process. Mm-hmm. And the second thing is, and you threw it out there, just a little side comment, but actually this is a very, very ingenious thing to do, which is, some people will genuinely just drop into a trance, and you can tell it. It's the whole body collapses. You can feel relaxation going through them. it feels a sudden way. You'll get it very quickly when it happens. Others will just be compliant, which means if you tip their head forwards, they'll bow forwards. There'll be a little bit more tension, a little bit more resistance, but generally speaking, because it's a performance, they're willing to go along with the piece. Now, the key thing here is, as far as everyone else is concerned, they've now been hypnotized. As long as you don't start, talking about it too much, it fudges the boundaries of reality. Now, the reason this is important is because everyone else that's watching now goes, oh my God, did you see what he just did? Maybe he'll do that to me. Their expectation has just shot through the roof, so the next person is more likely to respond more powerfully, which ironically means the first person who's kind of here or there, not quite sure, when he later on sees this other person completely tranced out, is likely to go the same way. But because you haven't mentioned anything, that, shall we say, dual reality is bouncing off each other and building into a more hypnotic reality by observing other people doing their thing.
Indeed. One other thing I'd say about this is once I've done it, I've seen people kind of oversell it and sort of say, well, you know, wasn't that weird? And maybe they're thinking, that's just not that weird, or I did that at school, or that's like the thing with your arms in the door. It doesn't matter if I'm doing this, because I'm not going to give the person a chance to speak and have a conversation about it. I am going to roll straight in to the next thing that I'm going to do. In the example I'm going to give you, I'm now going to do magnetic hands. Sometimes I'll go straight in for the real induction, if you like. I'm just going to move on from there. Let me give you something of real value. And again, this comes straight from my dad, Freddie Jacquin. I've seen him use magnetic fingers. He turns it into a finger lock. For those of you that have my book, you'll know that I produce supplements to it and I send them out to people. And this is outlined in there. I've seen him do this to 200 people in a seminar and have 200 people with their hands locked together. I'm going to spell it out. I won't explain it in too much detail. But what you're going to do is when their fingers touch and their eyes close, you're going to do this. We do it one of two ways. We'll either do it with something they want to achieve, a goal, something they really want to do, or we'll do it with a loved one. But this is what we'll do. We'll say, now, with your eyes closed, I want you to think about the person who is dearest to you on this planet. Get an image of that person in your mind. When they're there, just nod your head so that I understand. And I want you to enjoy this. I want you to see their face, see their smile, see their eyes, hear their laughter, hear their voice. Perhaps enjoy a pleasant memory. Feel what you feel for that person. And as you feel that, and as you listen to my voice, your fingers are becoming stuck and bolted together, glued together, stuck together. You cannot pull them apart. You can try and pull them and find they're stuck. It's very subtle, but the main thing there is I'm raising levels of emotion. They tend to dissociate out of their body and into a memory when they think about this person. And then you're going to use this linking language. It's very simple, but you're simply going to say, and as you feel that feeling, and as you listen to my voice, your fingers are becoming stuck and bolted together, glued together, stuck fast. When you try and pull them apart, you'll find they're stuck. And
this is an ingenious approach, I've got to say. A really powerful approach.
We use this in therapy. There's so many ways. We use this for leverage at certain points in therapy sessions. Because they're emotionally involved, because they're thinking of a loved one or a goal, they don't want to let go of it. And I don't know whether they make an association in their mind that, well, if they can, I can assure you this is massively effective. And in fact, this is almost too effective for me to do when I'm performing on stage, because I will get 70, 75% of the audience locked. You can then push the test from there. But just listen to that again. Just listen to that exact bit of language again. It's not particularly complicated, but it's just, and as you do that, and as you listen to me, which kind of puts the bit of power back to you, the hypnotist, a bit of influence back to you, your fingers are becoming. You still haven't really tested it. You're just saying they are becoming. And as we get into this more, you're going to hear that I'm constantly putting suggestions ever so slightly in the future. It's really easy to do, but a great skill to learn. If you've got the language patterns down, you can stretch out those moments, then it just allows you to buy yourself a bit of time so the idea genuinely takes hold. That's what I'd call the Jacquin finger lock in honor of Dad.
A great technique. And just to emphasize the ingeniousness of that process, folks, if you do nothing but what he just talked about now, and you do that with lots of little groups you meet along the way and so on, that in itself is a solid, entertaining, and very impressive bit of street hypnosis. Because you've given people, here's the thing, you've given people a powerful experience. You've shifted their reality by thinking about someone they love or a goal that's close to them and so on. And even if their hands don't get stuck, which is very unlikely because you shift the mind, as you correctly said, Anthony, there, to an emotional experience and you dissociate it from the hands by investing it in the idea. But even if that should fail and the hands come apart, it doesn't matter, because the primary experience, the one they're paying attention to, is the emotional one, and that is always worthwhile. I mean, you don't be surprised if at times people start maybe tearing up a little bit and so on, because it can be that powerful if you do it well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Another small point about that. Several years ago, I did some stage hypnosis training with John Chase. He's got a well-known book on stage hypnosis called Deeper and Deeper. He uses the first phase of Elman's eye lock. I think that's his kind of impromptu induction of choice. He outlines it in his book. He made the point to me that if their eyes are locked, they're hypnotized. Now, when I go back and read Elman, Elman would say, obviously, he's got his two-part definition, bypassing the critical one, establishing selective thinking. And Elman said, this is not hypnosis. This is just the entering wedge.
It's the wedge, now, exactly.
To be honest, I think John's more correct. Because if you've locked their eyes shut, as far as I'm concerned, their mind, it's not just the fingers coming together or the eyes closing. If you've locked them shut, their mind surely has locked around at least one idea that they can't open their eyes. So I think it's slightly more than the wedge. As far as I'm concerned, if I lock someone's fingers together, I'm a sentence away from sticking them to the floor or doing whatever else it is I want to do. So I very much see, if you're going to push this on from, wow, that shows me you can concentrate, you're going to be good at this, to the finger lockers outlined there, as far as I'm concerned, you're into it. You've now got a genuine binary test. Yes, there's a physical reason why they should come together. There is no physical reason why they would not be able to pull them apart. So if you've got that suggestion in that fashion and they're stuck, as far as I'm concerned, you're ready to go. You might as well say sleep at that point and get on with it. Anyway, let's move on because there's so much to get through. Let's take it at this point that you've just done magnetic fingers and they've closed their eyes and they've taken a deep breath. You haven't done it as an induction. I will then just say, okay, you can open your eyes. You can pull your hands apart. Excellent. That shows me you can concentrate. Okay. So it's very, very simple. It's an opportunity to give them a little bit of flattery. And where there's an opportunity to do that without it sounding over the top or just too much, then I'll say, excellent. That shows me you're going to concentrate. That's going to tie straight into the very next sentence I'm going to make when we get into magnetic hands.
It's also very important to give that bit of flattery because it basically tells them where their rewards will be. You're concentrating well, so you'll get a pat on the back. If you weren't concentrating well, or if someone was like playing the joke a little bit, they'll start getting more into line because their attention, well, rather, they won't have any attention paid to them unless they're concentrating well. So think, oh, I want attention, I better concentrate some more, right?
Absolutely. This also leads into the next thing I'm going to say, because I kind of set out the premise that I need you to concentrate and use your imagination. I'm going to do the next exercise with their eyes closed. You don't have to. And some people will argue that doing magnetic hands, again, a classic exercise again, with the eyes open is more powerful because they see their hands moving. I just want an excuse to get them to close their eyes so I can observe them. I'm looking for those eye movements at this point. I'm looking for whether they're comfortable. I'm trying to get them comfortable with the idea that their eyes are going to be closed for a while. I'm going to get into magnetic hands straight away, so you can pull your hands apart. Excellent. Now, I'll just deliver this first off, and then I'll break it down for you. Now, in a moment, I'm going to ask you to concentrate just like you did on your fingers, only this time I really need you to use your imagination. So in a moment, I will ask you to close your eyes. Is that okay? Good. I'm going to ask you in a moment to place your hands out in front of you like this, to close your eyes and imagine you have two very powerful magnets strapped to the palms of your hands, pulling them together. When they touch, your head can simply drop forward as before and you can relax, okay? What I've just done there is I've rehearsed, by the way. When I rehearse that, I do this for real, myself, my own hands out, my eyes are closed, and my hands come together in the time it takes me to get through that last paragraph of text, if you like. When I do that, I am now given an absolutely clear indication, this is what I want you to do. I'm showing them, look, I'm standing here with my arms out, my eyes closed, no one's gathering around us in a big crowd yet, you're not going to look that stupid. They've got a clear picture of what they want. So I give them that, and I've introduced this idea about imagination. That's the reason why they need their eyes closed, because I need them to use their imagination even more.
The other thing, of course, it does also is it formats the unconscious mind by telling the unconscious mind, this is the speed I want you to react at. Because otherwise, you might have, like, you know, the more, should we say, regular catalytic movements, or little jerky movements which happen one at the rate of every minute. So, like, 2 hours later, the hands are still coming together because they don't know what to expect, right?
Absolutely. So I've run through that, and then I'm going to get into it. And that's why I said I'd expect to be through the approach, the intro. I'll probably get through both these exercises within 2 minutes. That's genuinely how it normally works out. I've just done the rehearsal. I say, now, just place your hands out in front of you. Now, at this moment, sometimes with magnetic fingers, but often at this moment, this is the first moment where I'm going to begin to try and enter this person's personal space. If you remember, with magnetic fingers, I basically do it myself, so I don't really have an opportunity to touch them. This is my first real opportunity to do it. I'm going to say, okay, place your hands out in front of you. Just like with the setup and moving their chair, I will very lightly, very openly and obviously, with middle finger and a thumb and an index finger on their wrist, I will just take all their wrist as they do it and just make a tiny adjustment. Even if they're in the absolute textbook perfect position, I will just lift them up ever so slightly or move them together or move them apart ever so slightly, that kind of thing. Because now, although I haven't asked for permission to touch them at this point, I'm just going to say, yeah, that's right. And I'll just put them in the perfect position. As far as I'm concerned, a barrier is just dropped. I've now touched this person.
And you can tell very quickly whether that person is, shall we say, aversive to touch, because even that light adjustment, there'll be an extra tension or a jump or something like that.
Yeah.
If that happens, you know, oh, this person might be more touch shy, I'll have to be more careful with them, I might focus on the other people instead or something like that.
Yeah, exactly, if their eyes suddenly dart in your direction, but I want them focused on their hands. So I'm going to say, okay, place your hands out in front of you, look at the gap between those hands, get a clear picture of your hands stuck out there, there's your embedded command. Now close your eyes and imagine you have two powerful magnets strapped to the palms of your hands, pulling them together. They are already starting to go. Imagine that magnetic force is getting stronger, the closer they get, the stronger it becomes. That's right, fingers twitching, arms moving, just like you're a child playing with magnets and you felt that force pulling them together. Now I know it's difficult to tell exactly when they're going to touch. I can assure you they're going to touch. That's right. Now let your hands drop down, your head drop forward, and just relax. Take a nice deep breath in, breathe out. Excellent. Open your eyes. That's typically how it plays out. There is so much in what I've just said there. Yes, I am selling this, the same idea, in six or seven ways again. It's just variety rather than saying magnets, stronger. I'm trying to put it to them as much as I can. I use the same kind of language I used when I did it to myself. So the line about, and they'll move together like this, and it's difficult to tell where they are with your eyes closed, but they will touch. And then when they're doing it, I say, I know it's difficult to tell exactly where they are, but they are going to touch. And if you heard, I mentioned the kind of ideomotor type movement there. You can lie a little bit with they're already starting to go, or, you know, you've got a centimeter to go. If there's 2 inches to go, it doesn't matter. They'll still, but they don't know where they are, so they'll still get there. But the other thing about it is that close and close, that's right, you're doing brilliantly. You've got little opportunities to flatter them again and let them know that they're just doing okay. But if you see a finger twitch or you see an arm movement that's clearly unconscious in origin, if you like, then pace it and say, that's right, you might notice fingers twitching, that's right, arms moving, or hand shaking. Whatever you see that's a green light for you, pace it, bring it into their conscious awareness, and you're going to start to get feedback rather than just thinking, I've got to get their hands together. That's not the point of this. The point of this is to start to get some feedback, to give them some feedback, and to create this kind of hypnotic loop, this relationship. Everything I said with regard to turning magnetic fingers into this kind of fractionated induction applies here. So when they touch, I say, that's right, so your hands drop down, that's right, sleep and relax deeper and deeper. I'll rock their shoulder and off they go. And if I'm going to use that as this kind of fractionated induction, then typically there I will then say to them, in a moment I'm going to say, 1, 2, wide awake, your eyes will open, you'll be ready to be hypnotized. Nod your head if you understand. 1, 2, wide awake. Excellent. You've got a great imagination, you're going to be good at this. It's a small thing. It almost flies by the people who are watching in one sense. In the sense that you said it, they get a very clear view of, wow, look, that person looks hypnotized. What's going to happen next? Mm-hmm. In terms of what the person's just done, they don't know how it proceeds. I've said the word sleep. As far as they're concerned, they should be hypnotized at this point. And when I say in a moment, I'll say 1, 2, wide awake, even if they're thinking, well, I'm not asleep, it doesn't matter, because what I'm saying is, and your eyes will open and you'll be ready to be hypnotized. Nod your head if you understand. It's not quite a double bind in terms of the sentence construction, but it's like, well, are you going to stay there with your eyes shut forever, or are you going to nod your head and be ready to be hypnotized? You said you were already. You know,
it's very elegant. It goes back to this idea we talked about earlier, this dual reality, because people who are watching will think it's already worked. The person who's there, either they're convinced it's already worked, in which case they'll just do it again, so it sounds like an instruction that they'll do it again, or they don't think they've been hypnotized yet, but they've had enough other experiences to make it a positive thing and go, sure, I'll give that a go. Either way, you're in this sort of ambiguous soup where most people assume hypnosis is going on, and especially with things like 1, 2, wide awake, if you're saying wide awake, it assumes that they were asleep before and so on, right?
Yep. Just another thing about attitude at this point, when I'm doing this, and you'll see when I get into the inductions as well, it's very much the same thing. This might sound a little bit odd, but I try and take ownership of their arms, ownership of their fingers, not just their mind. Mm-hmm. I think of them as being props. I think of them as objects just floating in space. And I think of their arms as my arms. They belong to me. They respond in the way that I want them to respond. And I fully expect this to happen. And it's so rare that you can't get through these exercises successfully. The vast majority of people will succeed. And hopefully you will have got a decent amount of feedback. And by this point, you should be feeling good. If I'm not, then I don't have to go any further. As you said about magnetic fingers, this can be my demonstration. You know, you don't have to make people do ridiculous things. I could walk out of there, they would still know I'm the hypnotist.
Absolutely. You know? It's a great – what I really like about this whole sequence is, number one, it's a no-brainer. If you do it in a group larger than one person, you know, even if it's just two people, at least one of them will have some relatively significant experience somewhere along the lines so that they'll go, yeah, that was really cool. Now, even if you walk away, then it's great. And if you're just starting off and you're afraid of all the bigger things, then just do this for a while and get used to it, because this is the backbone of the whole system, right?
Absolutely. It's no different. If you're a magician, then there's a move. It's called a classic force. It's where you spread through a pack of cards, but you actually force a particular card on someone. It's it's quite tough to do. It's one of those things that, you know, when it's in an expert's hands, it's incredible. It doesn't matter where you go, you're getting the same card each time. And that's how it should feel. To master the classic force, you use it when you don't need to use it, you know, and it's the same with this. When people are just getting started, I say, look, just go out there, master these two exercises, show them something interesting. Don't even mention hypnosis. Just say, let me show you something interesting about the power of your mind. Roll through these two exercises until you can spit them out exactly as I've spat them out there. Again, I'm not saying that as use the exact wording, but I mean with a natural flow, the person does not have an opportunity to become the dominant party and ask questions and talk about it. Just roll through it. Give them a bit of flattery that you mean. Great. That shows me you can concentrate. Excellent. That shows me you've got a good imagination. You're going to be good at this. And then we're going to roll straight into the induction from there.
And I just want to put my wholehearted agreement to what Anthony's just saying there, because you're so right. A lot of people overload because they're trying to do too much at a time, and you're much better off. Just keep it simple. This itself, you can milk so much performance value out of this that people think you're a hypno god just by getting those fingers to touch, even though it's a mechanical or primarily a mechanical experience. And it teaches you all of the performance elements, which even if you're doing hypnotherapy as a hypnotherapist, you are still a performer. And if you don't get that into your head, then you're not doing your clients, you're not giving your clients your best. And it's very important you get used to that process, right?
And you said that about the physical reasons for these things happening. I've got to say, my sole intention when I'm doing it is to make this happen with suggestion. As far as I'm concerned, I am making this occur with suggestion. I'm not in any way thinking, oh, I'm tricking the person. I hope they don't figure it out. And let's just say for the circumstances that you do magnetic fingers and the person says, yeah, but wouldn't my fingers come together? I'll just say, you're a sharp guy. Put your hands out in front of you. Is there any reason why your hands should come together?
Right.
No?
This is the beauty of it. And what they don't realize, of course, is even though the finger vice, the magnetic, the finger thing itself, is loaded, shall we say, to be more mechanical, although it's not 100%. I know people have kept their hands open despite that. Then it's already created a pre-suggestion. In other words, it's saying you've had one experience of things coming together. Now the second experience of things coming together, the unconscious mind gets the pattern more easily, which makes it more likely they're going to come together anyway, even though there's now no physical mechanism for it to happen, right?
Yeah, exactly. In fact, I did it on this night out the other night. It was a Spanish guy. I did it on him, and he came out, and he was like, I thought you were going to hypnotize me. And I just said, just warming you up. Just wanted to see if you can concentrate and use your imagination. 5 seconds later, he was out completely. So just make the most of it. Don't write it off. Go back to the 5 or 6 points I made with regard to what I'm trying to achieve with the set piece. It's not to fool. It's not to trick. It's to sell ideas to people and get them on board, get them fascinated and observe. So
exactly.
All of that stuff is there. Now, if you're ready, we'll move into the induction.
The thing that everyone is looking out for, which ironically is probably the least important part in the whole sequence, right?
Well, yeah, in a way. I mean, you'll know that you can do those exercises we've spoken about and you can be there. The first induction I teach in my training course is the handshake induction.
Lovely piece.
Yeah, as much as anything to get it out of the way. It's just like, let's just do it. This is the Holy Grail, or it certainly was a few years ago. Mm-hmm. I think we'd all read that 20-page Erickson essay on his ambiguous handshake hundreds of times before any of us found the courage to go and have a go. And as I said there, Ralph Slater was using a handshake induction in the 40s. I mean, I use all three, to be honest. I use Ellman's expectancy principle, the triple handshake. I use Erickson's ambiguous one now and again. I don't use it that much often in the kind of street context because I want to move a little faster. Generally, the one that I'm going to outline now, although I'm going to give you my own spin on it, I believe is credited to Richard Bandler. He's certainly the person I credit with it. And this is where you're going to reach over and take hold of their wrist. How he came up with that idea or where he got it from, I don't know. But if it goes back further than that, then let me know. But this is who I credit with this induction. But I just want to explain how I'd do it. We've just come out of Magnetic Hands. I'll either just say 1, 2, 1, right? Excellent, shows me you've got a good imagination. Or Open Your Eyes, excellent, that shows me you've got a good imagination. And I'll just stick out my hand right there. As I say excellent, as I give the compliment, it's a natural moment to stick out your hand. You put a big smile on your face, then their hand will come up. If it doesn't, I will just say, excellent, can I borrow your hand? As I say, and we'll talk about that line in a moment.
Can I just pause you there a second? And just to emphasize to people doing this, because a mistake I'm sure you see all the time happening is people stick their hands out and they've got this big grin on their face, like they're in, like a kid in a playground who'd whip his hand away at the last moment and make you feel like a fool.
Yeah.
That's the worst thing you can do. What you want to be doing is just doing like a normal, natural handshake so that there's no, should we say, sub-communication that are saying there's a trick going on here. They need to expect a genuine handshake so the hands just naturally pop up. And it will pop up naturally if you feel like it's a natural handshake to you.
Yeah.
You just interrupt yourself.
And as I say, given that they've already invested and succeeded and you're giving them a compliment, to me that is the moment. It's just excellent. You're basically saying, nice one, you know, you're putting your hand up, well done. It's a natural moment. There's no striking a deal
it
with
it. It totally fits the context because they think, oh,
exactly.
He's just congratulating me. Yeah,
excellent.
We shake hands when we congratulate. That's the normal thing.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, you just stick out your hand. When I reach over, you'll see there's like 5 or 6 inductions in my book where I take hold of someone's wrist or forearm. Most of them use this kind of slightly odd grip, but basically I'm going to use my thumb and my second finger on either side of their wrist, and I place my index finger on the back of their wrist. I don't grab their whole forearm. I don't take it like they're diseased or something either. It's a firm enough grip that I can control their arm and position it where I want, but it's light enough that I can be sensitive to the feedback I'm going to get from that arm. And that's really how I see it. We'll talk about the pattern interrupt bit of this. I mean, most people understand this as a classic pattern interrupt, and certainly that's part of it. But I know, because I've done this induction in slow motion numerous times, and the other induction I'm going to teach you in a moment, by the way, is almost exactly the same as this, but I'm going to ask to borrow their arm. The only difference is that instead of doing it with this so-called pattern interrupt, I'm going to say, are you left-handed or right-handed? Can I borrow your arm? Okay, but the words that come after that, the actions that come after that are exactly the same. Let's just talk through the handshake first of all. I stick out their hand. I take hold of, let's say I put out my right hand, their right hand comes up. My left hand, I'm going to reach over and I'm going to take hold of their wrist and I'm going to turn it so that their hand is now about 18 inches away from their face. I'm going to point at the palm of their hand and say, look at your hand. And I'm going to say that with some command, look at your hand. I'm going to immediately have a look at their eyes to make sure that's where they're looking. So if you plow on with this and they're looking at you.
Another mini test.
Yeah, look at your hand. Bang. Then I'm going to use the same language. I'm going to make 2 statements of fact, first of all. As that hand moves towards your face, your eyes will begin to change focus. And as you become aware of your eyes, close your eyes and sleep and go deeper, deeper, deeper. Now, let's just examine those few sentences. Again, I know that, I know it's very simple, but it's easy for people to miss what I'm trying to do. Okay, look at the hand. Obviously, they are looking at the hand. As that hand, I like to say that hand, can I borrow your arm? That hand, it implies it's kind of an abstract object. It's not their arm anymore. This arm belongs to me as far as I'm concerned. So as that hand moves toward your face, now I know it's going to move toward their face because I'm going to start moving it toward their face with my index finger on the back of their hand, okay? But I'm not going to do this with force. I'm going to do this with the absolute minimum amount of intervention because I'm trying to feel for when they get ahead of me. I'm trying to feel with that index finger for when their hand basically is racing ever so slightly above mine, because at that point I can let go and I've got a genuine idiomotor movement. So I'm going
to
say...
So just to emphasize, what we're doing here is you're beginning the motion yourself by very gently nudging it in the right direction,
yep,
just to kind of build a bit of momentum, but that nudge will unconsciously start being absorbed, shall we say, and it'll turn it into its own motion, in which case it'll back off, and then it becomes a genuine magic thing, right?
It's just another idiomotor movement as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
So I'm going to say, as that hand moves towards your face, I'm going to go with it. Sometimes you have to stay with it or you have to stay near it. Even just leaving the index finger on the back of their hand gives them the impression that you're still in
right,
contact, therefore they should still stay where they are. So
it's kind of like the classic hand catalepsy where you end up having a fingertip on the top of their hand and they feel like you're holding their hand up, but really all you're doing is you're touching the top of their wrist, which there's no way you can hold it up, but the mind hasn't quite caught up to that yet, right?
Yeah, our standard induction in therapy, it kind of grew out of a combination of the rehearsal induction in training trances, this pattern interrupt handshake, and just a direct induction. It's called the Jacquin power lift. And it ends up with exactly that. The person is in the leverage situation, their hands in the air, their eyes are closed, and your fingers just on the back of their wrist, and then you make the entire arm cataleptic by sort of changing tack and becoming very direct.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the same sort of thing here. I'm trying to get that sensitivity. I'm trying to feel. I'm trying to get some feedback. And again, I'm going to use this language. As that hand moves towards your face, that is a statement of fact. You cannot resist it because this is your experience of the world right now. It's coming towards you.
Absolutely.
Your eyes will begin to change focus. I'm not saying they're changing focus, you're feeling sleepy, they're closing. I'm saying your eyes will begin to change focus. If they have taken the instruction and look at their hand, this will also be a statement of fact, because there is a moment between 18 inches and 1 inch from their face where their eyes are going to have to change focus. So as your hand moves towards your face, your eyes will begin to change focus. So again, it's ever so slightly set in the future. And as you become aware of your eyes, that's my preferred line here, as you become aware of your eyes, which is kind of saying nothing other than put your attention back where I said I wanted it in the first place.
Right.
Okay. And then I'm just going to, my ideal situation then is their hands about 6 inches from their face. You can drop your hand in front of their face. You can click your fingers. I prefer to do both. So I just drop the hand down. I click the fingers and I say, close your eyes. And there's the command, and sleep. So again, it's a nice bit of pacing and leading. It's as that happens, as you notice that, boom. And they're gone. Now,
beautiful induction.
It's great induction. It is one of the easiest rapid inductions to do. It's one of the most effective. And in these kind of impromptu situations, I mean, you know, I appreciate on stage dropping people back on the floor. The main reason, I mean, it is a good induction, but basically it's visual. Your audience
right,
can see something happening.
500 people can see this person toppling over,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and you get a big gasp, but I've done my back in doing it. I don't do it anymore. With this, in a kind of impromptu situation with half a dozen people standing around, this is nice and visual. You've got someone's hand in the air, their hands on their face. And again, they're kind of physically, they're beginning to give in, they're beginning to submit. So as the hand moves towards your face, you become aware of your eyes, close your eyes and sleep. And again, turn up your intensity when you say close your eyes and sleep at the end. Now, the other thing I want to say about this, because this, again, a lot of people when they're trying to learn this stuff, this is such a classic mistake that I've just got to flag it up. They say sleep.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Oh.
And they stop talking and they look at them and think, are they gone? Are they there? Have I got them? Has it worked?
No. They sit there and they hold their breath and then they look like all nervous, and then the person kind of opens one eyelid up and go, what do I do next? And then, of course, what they see is this hypnotist looking like the whole world's come to an end, and they go, what happened? And of course, it is just. And ironically, it's so easy to avoid all that, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, I mean, I've explained that now. Let's imagine we've just said sleep. I won't say a lot else other than, you know, I'm going to explain the next bit when we get into the deepening. But I can tell you now, I do not pause. I say sleep. I put my hand on their shoulder and I'm into the deepening. I do not even pause to take a breath. I'm just going to continue.
Keep talking.
Exactly. Now, the point is, if the induction has failed in a sense, if they're not quite there yet, again, this is straight out of transformations, this concept of leverage. They're now standing there with their eyes closed, their hand in the air or on their face in a rather awkward position. You're playing catch. You've thrown the ball, but oh, look, it's still in your hand. It's still your go, Mr. Hypnotist. It is still your opportunity to continue to give them more instructions. So the important thing is don't stop. Just continue to talk. You've now got an opportunity, if you need to do it, to turn that arm drifting down into an induction. Or you could just start giving suggestions and make it cataleptic or make it float up toward the sky. It doesn't matter. There's so much you can do when you've engineered this little situation.
Or if you just want to bail out, you go back to your other set piece, which I think was charming, where, you know, think of a loved one as your hands locked more closer together. Or in this case would be, as your hand returns back to your lap, think of a loved one and have a strong, powerful emotion.
Exactly.
And you can just tiptoe away at that point and go, you see how good that was? Okay,
yeah, bye-bye, folks. That was a good feeling, was it not? There's always a kind of out. You know, I'm not the kind of guy that wants to make you walk like a chicken. So if I just, as that hand drifts down and the whole only as quickly as you can enjoy a very pleasant memory, they're not just going to put it down. They're going to enjoy a pleasant memory, regardless of whether they think they're hypnotized. So that's it on the handshake. It's going to take me much less time to explain what in my book I call eye-to-hand fixation. Someone pointed out that logically it should be hand-to-eye fixation. So I might make that adjustment. But again, this is what I call eye-to-hand fixation in my book. This, I guess, is slightly more permissive. The only thing that's different, literally the only thing that's different to the handshake induction I've just described, is that instead of sticking my hand out and interrupting a handshake, I'm going to get permission to do this. This is a lovely induction. This is the one I use most of the time. So we've just done magnetic hands. I've said, okay, take a deep breath, breathe out. Excellent. Open your eyes. You can take your hands apart. It shows me you've got a great imagination. I just say, are you left-handed or right-handed? Now, I love these, what I call process questions, things that are actually entirely irrelevant as far as I'm concerned. Whether they're left-handed or right-handed, it makes no difference to me. I'm going to work with the hand that I want to work with. I'm not that concerned about hemispheric dominance and all this kind of stuff. They come out of it, and they're probably expecting a bit of a chat. And I just look at them and say, are you left-handed or right-handed? And kind of gesture, are you left-handed or right-handed? And they just say, I'm right-handed. I say, can I borrow your arm? And I pointed it. I'm going to point it like it's an object, like I've just said, can I borrow your pen? Mm-hmm. Can I borrow your arm?
And this is very important, because what you're actually doing very subtly now is you're trying to dissociate that arm from their control. If
Precisely.
I'm borrowing it and they're actually symbolically handing it over, now you, the big hypnotist man, are in charge of that arm. It's a subtle point, and on its own won't necessarily, you know, move mountains, but it's a very powerful wedge from which you can build other things and add things on top of, right?
Yeah, and that's very much how I see the process. You know, everything we're going through here, every single step of the process is non-essential. You can just cut straight to the induction. You can just give suggestions. You can drop the set piece. You can drop the induction. You know, everything is kind of non-essential. If it's a balance of scales, then weight by weight by weight, nudge by nudge by nudge, I'm trying to shift things where I want them to be. I'm trying to topple it. And this is, like you say, it's a subtle thing. It's easily missed, but I just pointed it and say, can I borrow your arm? I've had people just stick their arm out like they're passing me a pen. I've had people say, if you give it back, I'll just say, can I borrow your arm? They say yes. And I reach in and I take hold of their wrist with the same grip I described before. But I do this with real purpose. When I take hold of their wrist, I don't just whip it straight up in front of their face. I take hold of it almost like, imagine looking at a cellist with their bow poised, just about to begin. They're waiting for their moment where they come into whatever piece it is they're playing. That's the manner I've got when I take hold of their wrist. I'm doing this in a very particular fashion. I'm doing this for a very particular reason. So I put my hand on their wrist in that fashion with these three fingers. I pause a beat. I lift it up nice and slowly, and I put it in exactly the same position I would put it in if I was doing a handshake induction. In other words, their palm is now 18 inches away from their face. What do I say? Look at your hand. Look at the lines on your hand. Look at one spot. In fact, I missed that with a handshake there. That's the three steps of setup. I say, look at your hand. Look at the lines on it. Look at one spot. As the hand moves towards your face, your eyes will begin to change focus. And as you become aware of your eyes, close your eyes and sleep. So just to backtrack there, I normally use this very quick three-step kind of setup. Look at your hand, look at the lines on it, look at one spot, just to fixate your attention. Are you left-handed or right-handed? Can I borrow your arm? Look at your hand. Look at the lines on your hand, look at one spot. As the hand moves towards your face, your eyes will begin to change focus. You become aware of your eyes, close your eyes, and sleep. People might argue, well, that's exactly the same induction, isn't it? And it is in a way, but it's just for people who are worried about the whole handshake thing.
It takes
the fear out, you know, because the handshake thing does require a bit of timing. And some people are a bit grabby. They just fumble it because they're trying to remember the lines. With this, it takes all of that race out of it. It takes all the fear out of it. And it's also much more permissive for the subject because you've said, can I borrow your arm? Excellent. And helps to create that dissociation.
It also gives you the sense that you can slow things so slowly that you're in control of every little movement rather than a handshake, because people think they've got to whip that hand up there and whip it to their face and everything has to happen quickly. It doesn't. Once you can do this version of it, actually the handshake is a no-brainer, because it's just basically, rather than saying, can I borrow your arm, you begin it non-verbally with your intended handshake, but then you just carry on from the same place. So that's a very elegant way of making something which seems a little daunting at times seem relatively straightforward, because it's just a step-by-step process then.
Yeah, a lot of people want to use the handshake. It's just an easier way of doing it, and it still gives you an opportunity to burn in the lines you're going to use and the actual physical actions. But just remember to use this as a kind of sensitivity exercise. You're trying to get some feedback from that arm. You're trying to make the ideal situation is that it moves toward their face with suggestion. And again, you're always going to link what's happening with what you want to happen, and when that starts to happen to the next thing, and so on and so forth. If you get someone, or if you need to practice a new induction, again, it's a very simple tip, but the induction that you want to practice, use it as your reinduction. You know they're going to go when you say sleep anyway, so it's another good way of practicing this time, if you like, for real. Right. Certainly, that's how I did it. When I first started using a handshake, I would use it as a reinduction until I had the kind of muscle memory, if you like, to do it with some sensitivity.
So I think we've got the induction down pat, and everything you've been talking about is very elegant, sophisticated, but if I could just focus people's minds on the one core idea behind everything, and you made a very elegant demonstration of that, Anthony, it's this. Once you say the word sleep, in other words, the instant bit of the induction is over, the key thing is they've got a little trance spike. They've popped into trance, but they'll start naturally, like a cork being thrown into water, start naturally kind of popping back out again, unless you do something to keep them there. So you have to keep talking. And what is it you keep talking about? Well, I think Anthony's about to tell us, aren't you?
Indeed. We're getting deep now.
That's right.
Let's get into some intensification. Now, I met a stage hypnotist a while back. He proclaimed very proudly, but just by looking at someone, he could tell where they were on any of 30 levels of hypnosis.
Ouch.
Good for him. I can't. I wouldn't even know what the 30 levels are, to be honest. The point is, at this point, you've hopefully gained a bit of information, but you're not going to stop. You're going to continue. I'm going to go through these ideas of kind of links to create deepening, loops, chains, and it's not mind-blowing stuff. It's just a concept. But the first thing I'm going to do when I've said sleep is I'm going to step in a little bit. I want to take control of this person physically. It's hard to say without sounding rather odd, but I want to kind of begin to slightly dominate this person physically, okay? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to do that with a very gentle hand on their shoulder. Not so gentle that it freaks them out and not so heavy that it pushes them over. But
so you're
as
not kind
I say,
of caressing their shoulder sexually squeezing it in a vice grip of death.
No, but what I want to do is I'm not going to necessarily seek permission for this, but I am going to let them know what I'm doing as I do it. So I've said sleep. I've dropped my hand in front of their face if you're using the induction. And I immediately will place my right hand on their left shoulder if we're kind of facing each other. And I will say, as I rock your shoulder, go deeper and deeper and deeper. Now, firstly, deepening, what is it? They're not actually going anywhere, are they? But again, like the word sleep, it's in the English-speaking world anyway, it is so closely equated with hypnosis that people seem to know what to do, and they seem to translate it as relaxing or getting into it more or just continuing to listen as much as anything else. So sleep, go deeper and deeper and deeper. As I rock your shoulder, you can continue to relax. So this is where I'm going to start to use very simple stuff, but a bit more of the kind of language skills that you're going to get from your kind of work. More of the, it's not entirely conversational, but pacing and leading and encouraging dissociation with your language. So I'm going to say sleep deeper and deeper and deeper. As I rock your shoulder, you can continue to relax. Now, this is where I'm really getting in. This hand on their shoulder now is giving me feedback. So as I say, as I rock your shoulder, I'm trying to feel, like, where are they at right now? Are they stiff as a board? Are they relaxed completely? Or as I say, as I rock your shoulder, again, it's as I, you can continue or you can begin. I'm not actually saying it. I'm not saying you're becoming more relaxed, you're going twice as deep or anything else. I'm just saying as I rock your shoulder, you can continue to relax. And as I rock their shoulder, I'm talking millimeters back and forward here.
Mm-hmm. But of course, in the trance subject, it's all heightened because their awareness is heightened. So it feels like a real gentle rocking, like, you know, being on a rocking horse as a kid or something like that, right?
It's just a gentle kind of rocking back and forward. I'm trying to get some feedback. As I say, you can continue to relax. I'm thinking, are they loosening up? I'm not only thinking it, I'm just feeling it. It's just, we're starting to go now. We're starting to get some momentum. Now, if in your setup, you place their feet together, which if they're standing up, I would always do, I'm now absolutely in control of their center of gravity. So if I wanted to push them over, it'd be very easy for me to push them over. I don't want to do that yet, but I'm now in control of them. So they have to allow that. They have to allow that to happen. The only way they can't allow it is to tense up. So I'm going to feel that.
Can I just pause you there for a second? Because I think you just said something very, very important in this whole sequence, which is when you take control of someone's, for example, center of balance, they have to allow it, which means that you have a very, very powerful indirect test. Are they holding on to their balance, which means they want to be in control of the process unconsciously at some respect, at some level, or are they giving you their balance, which is a big thing to give to someone,
massive.
At which point you know that you're in very good shape because they've given you something pretty fundamental to their well-being.
Yeah, this is, you know, it's like a trust exercise. Most of the time you're going to feel it. When we get into these deepening things, one of the things I want to do is I want to link one thing to another. So as I rock your shoulder, you can continue to relax, go deeper and deeper and deeper. In the absence of anything else, I've now got another feed that I can pace and lead. There you go. Right. I don't mean to rhyme there, but that's what I want to do. If they're giving
me
anything.
You're a poet and you didn't even know it.
Yes, I like to rhyme most of the time. Taking me back to my school days. The point about this is if they're exhibiting any classic signs of hypnosis, I will pace them. That's right. As your eyes flicker, you can continue to relax. If their breathing shifts, that's right. With every deep breath, you can continue to go deeper and deeper down. So first off, the first level of deepening, if you like, is just to say deeper and deeper. Just do it directly with suggestion. Second level for me is to link one thing to another. So as this happens, as that happens, as I rock your shoulder, going deeper and deeper, that kind of thing. Very, very simple. It's just say what you see. You know, if there's anything there that's indicating to you this is going well, then say it and link it. If they're doing something that you think could potentially pop them out, like they laugh or they grin or they snip, it doesn't matter what it is, then just say that's right. As you smile, you can continue to relax. So just linking one thing to another. The next kind of level for me is to create these little loops. And again, these are almost so cliche in hypnosis, but you're not hypnotizing a hypnotist most of the time. So go deeper. As you notice your eyes flickering, you can continue to drift deeper. And the deeper you go, your eyes will flicker even more, that kind of thing. Link deepness to flickering. The deeper you go, the better you're going to feel. The better you feel, the deeper you go.
That's, of course, the classic one. And it's a classic circular loop. And it's very, very powerful. It's
incredible.
Mind.
I can barely think of a situation where I wouldn't say that. Because don't you want to feel better? It's just, it's fantastic. Even as you wonder how deeply you've drifted, you can continue to drift down, going even more deeply relaxed, that kind of thing. This is just words as far as they're concerned, but you're sewing these little loops into their mind. You're linking one thing to another, and now you're joining the ends. You're starting to relax them. Another line I use a hell of a lot of the time, again, this is a soft little test. As your body moves and relaxes, again, I'm rocking their shoulder, just going deeper and deeper. That's right. Your legs will support you. I love saying this to people. Mm-hmm. Your legs will support you. As they start to look relaxed, your legs will support you, even as you continue to relax deeper and deeper. Now, what I'm actually looking for when I say that, you will see it. The moment you say your legs will support you, you will often find people give with their legs a little bit. It's like, oh, because now they can let go of this tension in their legs, but they know they're not going to fall over. So it's like your legs will support you. Boom. I'd expect to see a little half inch of kind of knee bend, just like as I continue to rock them back.
And of course, importantly, it prevents them from collapsing all over you or the floor, which can be very embarrassing sometimes, like on a tube station, for example.
It can. I found this when we go out in bars and stuff like that. They're very happy for us to do this. If you get permission, that kind of stuff, they're very happy for us to do this and hypnotize people. And however outlandish the kind of routines we get into are. However, the moment you put someone on the floor, that's it. It looks like someone's passed out.
It's not a happy moment.
Oh, and it's all over. you know, your leg support, that kind of thing. And then it's not that much different, but setting up a chain, something that's ongoing in their experience. And again, these are cliche lines, but they work a treat. Every breath you take will take you deeper and deeper. Every word I say, every beat of your heart, you know, whatever is a continuous part of their ongoing experience, you link that to going deeper, and they've got nowhere else to go. There's a lot of things, a lot of the countdowns, down some steps, walk on the beach, all that kind of stuff. They work just fine. They're just not really for me.
What you've done there is you've taken the concept of suggestion, really, and pared it down to its most fundamental, the idea of the law of association. You know, you link two ideas in the mind, and the mind accepts them as the same thing. Now, the heart's going to keep beating. It's just part of how we're being set up. So if you link to it the idea of a deepening process, well, now they've become the same thing, and for the duration of that experience, they will be the same thing, which is very, very elegant way of doing it. Which is not to say, by the way, that people can't do all these other things, but they don't have to. They can keep it very simple.
They don't have to. I mean, I know when I first did a stage show, I'd written this in, and it took exactly the time I'd written it in for. I did 10 minutes of deepening. My father came along to see this show. He was up in the balcony. Obviously, he's been doing this a long time. Afterwards, he said, the moment I tipped their head back for the drop back, he was like, I could see they were hypnotized. Why did you do all that deepening?
I safety blanket, you know?
Yeah, I'd kind of written it in. The other thing that so when I'm on the street, let me just say this, when I'm on the street, this deepening process, I might spend 30 seconds. So it's like deeper and deeper and deeper. As I walk your shoulder, you can continue to relax. Every breath you take, every word I say, that's right, going deeper and deeper and deeper now. As you relax, your legs will support you. You're doing brilliantly. I'm still dropping the encouragement and that kind of stuff. But literally, I'm going to whiz through this stuff pretty quickly. This is also an opportunity, if you wish, to drop in what I call the procedural instructions. If you're planning to wake them up and put them back in and all that kind of stuff, health and safety if it's required, in terms of should we need to leave the building and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. This is where I'm going to drop all this stuff as swiftly and as succinctly as I can. It doesn't matter if you have to script this stuff out and learn it in that fashion. So I'm going to say, from this moment forward, when I say sleep, you'll immediately return into this state, going twice as deep. When I say 1, 2, wide awake, your eyes will open. You'll be able to move and speak normally, acting perfectly on the suggestion I've given you. Nod your head if you understand. That's right. Continuing to relax deeper and deeper. I'll just get out a couple of procedural instructions at this point as well.
Let me just take a little stop at what we've got here, because we spent about 2 hours now talking about what really in real life will take maybe 4 minutes, because we spent about 20 seconds doing the approach. We've done about, in the terms of the setup, that's maybe another 30 seconds to minutes. We're about in a minute and a half so far. Now we're going into your set pieces. They may take a little bit longer. They might take all of a whole minute, maybe a minute and a half each. So 2 minutes in total for this set. So we've got maybe into 3.5, 4 minute mark. The induction itself, well, if that takes more than a minute, then you've really stretched it out a long time. So we're past the 5 minute mark. The deepening is about 30 seconds. So you know, even if you're slowing this right down, you spent 6 minutes with a complete stranger.
That would be. Yeah, that would be
pretty
slow.
That would be the outside arm, right?
That would be a 3 minute intro, I think.
Exactly.
Again, it's not for the purpose of racing. It's just, let's get to the point of actually finding out if this person's capable right now in this mood with this hypnotist is going to go any further. So, you know, again, it took me many years, because I came into this via the indirect approach. And again, I still love it and I still use all the language. But I really believe that within 2 minutes, you will be in exactly the same place. And on the street, no time to sit there being indirect. You want to get into it. So straight from this 30 seconds of deepening, I am going to go into my first, what I would think of as my first routine. But if you like, even though we've been soft testing, giving them these little prods along the way and getting some good feedback, now I'm really into the suggestion phase of this, and I'm going to start. Now, for me, without any huge rationale, this is what makes sense to me and what works for me. I tend to proceed from what I call physical suggestions. By that, I mean things like arm levitation and catalepsy, into emotional shifts, so suggestions for laughter, suggestions for just anything that's going to get this person experiencing a raised level of emotion, into what I'll call mental suggestions. They would be things like amnesia, or losing abilities to do things, or being incredibly brilliant at being able to do things. And then once I've kind of established amnesia, I'm generally feeling pretty good that I'm happy to move anywhere I want to move, so I'll go into hallucinations and all that kind of thing. It doesn't have to proceed that way. You don't have to work that way. I've done an induction and just told someone I'm Denzel Washington, not a great deal else. But the point is that as a rule of thumb, this is what I do, this is what works for me, and this is how I train people. So physical, emotional, mental, and then go anywhere you like after that. Perfect. So they're now there. Let's imagine their hand is still in front of their face at this point. They don't look happy with that hand in front of their face. I'll let them out of that. I'll say, in a moment, your hand will drift down only as quickly as you can drift down with it. As the muscles relax, you can relax. If it was still there, I might start to use that hand. I might just leave it there because I like the fact that it's still
very visually dramatic, right?
It's very visually dramatic, and that I know they're still committed. You know, they're not feeling so silly that they need to put it down. They're happy. Typically, my first suggestion is for arm levitation. If you've got the skill to do magnetic hands, then you've generally got the skill to do an arm levitation. So I will say this. So we've done the deepening now. Again, I'll place the suggestion in the future. I'll give their mind a little chance to catch up. In a moment, I'm going to touch the back of your hand and it's going to begin to lift up towards your face. It's going to get lighter and lighter and lighter. I'll touch the back of your hand and it will start to lift up like it's being pushed up on a cushion of air, like it's being pulled up on an invisible wire. And at some point in that little sequence, probably toward the end of it, I'll make a very deliberate touch on their hand. I'll leave my finger there for a couple of seconds and then I'll just pull it away like pop. I'm expecting it to just float up immediately. I'm not expecting their hand to shoot up, but I know and fully expect and want at this point that when I take my finger off, there's going to be a movement. In lots of these things, you'll know you can encourage it up by setting up a bit of tension in the other direction. And that's kind of one of the things I'm doing here. So I'm going to place a little bit of pressure on their hand. It's very deliberate. And when I let go of it, I'm very pop. It's just like I'm expecting that to have an effect. And it usually does. Their hand starts to come in that direction. What am I going to do? I'm going to do what I've been doing all along. I'm going to pace their experience. I'm going to let them know what's happening. That's right. It's starting to go. It's starting to lift. That's right. Higher and higher, lighter and lighter, up towards your face, up toward the ceiling, up toward the sky. You know, send this thing wherever you want. But again, now this is really starting to look a bit odd. So people that are watching, because their elbow won't bend, the arm will just move as a whole, a complete item. Or you'll get the classic ideomotor type movements where it will start to twitch. Their fingers will lift up first or something on their wrist. Say what you see. Whatever's happening is correct. Just say, that's right. Wrist lifting, muscles twitching now. Fingers are about to come off your leg. That's right. Just ever so slightly putting those suggestions in the future. And they're going to start to sell this to themselves at this point. I'm not really challenging it. I'm not saying you can't stop it. Try and find your canard. I'm just suggesting it, just like I was with magnetic hands. So
this is still the kind of a warm-up part of the...
It is in a way, but for me, this is my first routine because this is bigger. This is slightly more powerful than doing something like magnetic hands. It's much more visual. And I know that if I get the hand lifting, I can link it to the next thing I want to be doing, which is an emotional suggestion.
Right.
I won't cover catalepsy and sticking people to things and all that kind of stuff. For now, let's just kind of stick with the basics here. I'm going for arm levitation, either toward their face or up toward the ceiling. If you do it toward the ceiling, their arm tends to stay straight. If you do it toward their face, obviously their elbow's got to bend at some point, and you might as well make that happen. That's right. As it lifts, again, you're going to notice your elbow beginning to bend as it moves towards your face. I'll tell them what I want, and then I'll pace that as it begins to happen. At some point en route to their face, let's say, we're going to get into an emotional routine, the one I kind of outline in my book. I think I call it briefer therapy. It's very, very simple. As it lifts, I'm going to tell them that it's going to make them feel good. And I've seen Banda doing this, not really as a routine in this way, but I've seen him linking laughter to a hand moving toward their face, and then he very rapidly pushes it toward their face and tries to sort of anchor that. This is very similar to that kind of idea. As it lifts up toward their face, I say, that's right, lighter and lighter, you're doing brilliantly, higher and higher. The closer it gets to your face, the better you're going to feel. That's not really saying a great deal, but it's an entering wedge into where I'm going with this. So as it lifts up towards your face, higher it gets, the better you're going to feel. In fact, you're going to have an unusual sense of well-being. And as it continues to lift, this is going to start to seem funny to you. What I'm looking for, as I say that word, seem funny to you, I'm thinking, I'm wanting, I've got a smile on my face. I'm wanting this person to smile. The moment they smile, it's rock and roll, I'm away. That's right. Their smile is going to turn into a giggle or a grin. That grin is going to turn into a chuckle. That chuckle is going to turn into a laugh. And by that point, I'm just trying to burp. And then I know I've got another moment. Something I haven't mentioned yet is I'm very much into these strong moments. There's a moment where the hand first moves. There's a moment where it leaves your leg. There's a moment where it touches your face. There's a moment where it leaves. So each of those moments I know is coming. So I'm going to link something to it in advance. A growing sense of well-being, an unusual sense of well-being. This is going to start to seem funny to you. That's right. That smile is going to turn into a chuckle. That chuckle is going to turn into a laugh. And when it touches your face, you are going to laugh as inappropriately as you possibly can. That's right. Bang.
Just to pause you there for a second, because something very important you're doing here as well is you're giving people incremental instructions. You're not saying, as your hand lifts, you're going to laugh hysterically like a hyena. Yep. That's too big a jump for them to go from totally relaxed and inside.
Yeah,
to
I mean,
totally
some people are capable of that, but for me, it's going to take me another 3 seconds to do it incrementally. So,
you may as well give them that transition to make it smooth for them, right?
The reason I work this way is probably because of my background and where I've come from in terms of using idiomotor movements in therapy. I had to work hard for a long, long time to kind of really master that stuff. And it's all about kind of this incremental build.
It just means you hit with a wider range of people. In other words, you'll get a better result with more people overall. Can you get the same result in a quicker time with one or two individuals? For sure. But you're just hedging your bets this way, aren't you?
Yeah. Once they've kind of committed to a smile and they committed to a little chuckle, then, well, they really haven't got an option. But the point is, there's a moment between, it's going to start to seem funny, kind of voluntariness and a sense of involuntariness to this being a complete and utter unconscious act. So when that hand touches their head, and I have said, as inappropriately as you possibly can, and you'll see now why I consider this my first routine, what I'm wanting is absolute unbridled laughter. And some people interpret, I've had, on that one word interpret, I've had someone do the Dick Dastardly laugh. You know? Other people, it's just a massive unbridled laugh that is kind of inappropriate for the context they're in, of sitting in a restaurant, sitting at a table or whatever. That's what I want to get to. Even if they just smile, even if they just laugh and feel good, well, I've now got a new bailout. If suddenly that's as far as this is going to go, all that really manifested was arm levitation, well, that's pretty spooky for people who are watching, and it's going to be a feel-good experience for the person who smiled. So there's another opportunity for me to bail out,
and
claim...
Just to emphasize to people here, even though this is like we're in the five-minute mark at this point in terms of doing it properly... if you've set it up properly and follow the steps we've been talking about, you have a tremendously entertaining and powerful demonstration. You've done the finger sit, you've done the hand magnets, you've done an arm levitation, you've done an emotional shift. So you've basically done four demonstrations in that very, very short period of time. People go, wow, if he can do this stuff in 5 minutes, what can he do with an hour's time?
Yeah,
so it really creates that expectation, doesn't it?
And it's all been feel good up to this point as well. Mm. We're really kind of rolling with this now. However, I've got to become the evil hypnotist at some point, and once I get the unbridled laughter...
You'll get your monocle out, your top hat, and off you go.
This is where it tends to go now. I've been doing this routine so long with the laughter that about 18 months ago, it just popped into my mind to say to someone, now when I click my fingers, you're going to laugh like a girl. Bang. Off they started tittering away. Now when I click my fingers... you're going to laugh like a posh old lady. and I will always start them off. Whenever I say that, you're going to laugh like a posh old lady. They immediately bite on it. You're going to laugh like a laughing policeman. But yeah, ooh, and off. They've got that in there. Off they go. Now, this is riotous when you do this for a group. Laughter's infectious, so it's one thing making people feel good with it. But the moment this suddenly turns now from being arm levitation and a nice smile on their face and laughter to being, bang, absolute black and white control now.
And this is a huge drama point in the whole demonstration, isn't it?
It's massive. It's massive. If they're laughing, and I say it's off the hook in that fashion, then you should feel confident that now you're into this. You're into this good and proper now. So my laughter routine basically rolls like this. It's just, you're going to laugh like this. You're going to laugh like a little girl. You're going to laugh like a posh old lady. You're going to laugh like an evil demon. And I can tell you, when you say that to people, it's just, I've been scared myself with some of the laughs that have emerged. My good friend Amit Badiani, who features on the Manchurian Approach, he's a good subject. I've done him with this kind of posh lady and the evil demon laughter himself. Took it a step further and said to somebody, I think he was actually hypnotizing them over Skype, which is a very naughty thing to do, but he said to them, you're going to laugh like a pig. And of course, they start laughing and snorting. He then said, you're going to laugh like two pigs laughing together. That has now become, you're going to squeal like two pigs having a fight. And so on and so on. I don't really need to go any further. But this becomes big and loud and it's dramatic and you're performing with it now, and this person is now
right
on
now,
show
now,
never
now
stopped.
You're in the show and suddenly the crowd that's pulling in at this point, yeah, because this is too bizarre to ignore, right?
Absolutely. And now let me tell you, the only thing that's more dramatic at this point, and this is the only way to end this routine, is to say, at the very height of this, to say, now stop laughing and sleep.
Right, because now you've gone instant, like the tap's been turned off, and like, what the heck just happened
exactly,
there?
Exactly, and they are out. And they've still got, you know, think about it, they've still got all the chemicals running around their body and brain from all of that laughter and all that feeling good. And it's just like, now stop laughing and sleep. Bang. And suddenly it's like, this guy really is a hypnotist, and they know it. So
now, if you walked away at that point, you were walking away to a real high point.
I'm quite happy to walk away at that point. No problem at all. No problem at all. We call that corpsing someone, just making them laugh, really. Just getting them laughing as much as you can. You'll find other people will just crack up. That's kind of my first routine.
It's a very powerful routine. And basically, once you've got that, once you've corpsed them out and they're in this deep trance and everything's been shut off, to be honest with you, getting a simple mental effect like, a numb arm, or like, I know you like to use amnesia.
Yeah.
That's just the question of saying, just basically saying it directly. You know, in a moment, I'm going to count to three and you'll open your eyes wide awake and you'll have forgotten that we've even hypnotized you. You'll be convinced that we haven't even started yet and so on.
Yeah.
And then you're done. I mean, at that point, you can pretty much go anywhere you want with this, can't you?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Anthony, this is a very ingenious system you've built up here. And I've got to say, the thing I really like about this is it's just a very smart understanding of the hypnotic principles and using the simplest, mechanisms that express a lot of powerful principles. And the sequencing you put together is beautiful. It's a very, very elegant and very powerful sequence.
Thank you very much. It means a lot coming from you.
Well, I take my hat off to you, because I think you are, and this is the other thing I like about your work, and folks, please do listen to this interview again, because it comes out time after time when Anthony's talking. You're not just doing, like a lot of people do street hypnosis, just do instant inductions and maybe stick someone's hand to the floor or something, which is impressive and it's definitely worthwhile. But you're innovating. You've gone from laughing to laughing like a pig to, you know, becoming invisible.
Yeah.
You're doing interesting new things with this. And this is where we grow our skills as hypnotists. I mean, you know, street hypnosis in itself is a fun thing to do, but really, as a hypnotist, it should help you grow what you're capable of, right?
Absolutely. I'm going to explain one other routine. Rather than putting hundreds of routines in my book, I wrote up 6 or 7 originally, but wrote every word from A to Z in terms of what I would say. The next routine, I've been doing it for a year or so, and I'm going to put a caveat into this right away.
Okay.
In that this is something that I'm putting out there to illustrate a principle. In fact, I meant to speak about this in the last interview. Okay. In terms of getting the truth out of people. Okay.
Right.
So I'm not suggesting you go and use this routine in the way
your husband or your boyfriend says, have you been dating someone else?
That wouldn't be as bad as doing it in the middle of a show. If you did this in the middle of the show and someone's come along and they've walked into this innocently and you were to do what I'm about to explain, you could completely wreck the person's life by having them expose themselves in some way. The reason I'm explaining it is that it can be a big fun routine if you just take the hard edge off it, which I will explain how to do. The other reason I want to explain it is it ties into everything else we were talking about in terms of what is possible. I was reading just recently in a book called Hypnosis, Cognitive Theory, I think, of Hypnosis by Spanos and somebody else, and they're very much into their kind of social compliance.
Exactly,
simplifying it too much, but they're very much into that model. And there's a bit about hypnosis and the law or legal uses. Can you use it to get the truth out of people and that kind of thing? And they basically come to the conclusion that you can't. And I appreciate that people can lie under hypnosis. You can fantasize under hypnosis and believe you're telling the truth, but not. Mm-hmm. If you have hypnotized someone and just say, give me your PIN number, they can lie. They can believe they're giving you their PIN number and not, but they can also give you their PIN number for real. So it is possible to get the truth out of people. And the routine I'm going to explain now, we've gone through this kind of physical and emotional stuff. This is what I'd classify as a mental routine. And rather than just talking about amnesia, hopefully it will be of interest to your listeners. Mm-hmm. So we call this the truth and liar routine, or the liar and truth routine, I should say, because that would be more accurate. It starts off like this. So I've just said, stop laughing and sleep, and they're back in. In a moment when I say 1, 2, wide awake, your eyes will open. You'll be the world's biggest liar. Everything you say will be a lie. You're the compulsive liar. each lie will be more outlandish or bigger than the last. Okay, so again, I'm going to dictate their response. Just like in other things, I'd say when I do a mind reading effect of hypnosis, and I say with each thing I say, you'll be even more amazed, even more astonished, so that it has some build. So in this sense, I'll say each lie will be bigger than the last. So this is very much a kind of stage hypnosis situation. It's very funny. Obviously, you can do this on the street. By stage hypnosis, I mean it's all about laughs. They're going to lie.
Absolutely.
So I say, you're going to be a huge liar, compulsive liar. Everything you say will be a lie. And then it comes out, your mouth will be a lie. Each lie will be bigger than the last. Nod your head if you understand. And I'll quite often say that just to get that verification. There's no harm in saying that. One, two, wide awake. Okay, so they open their eyes. I'll look at them and say, what's your name? And they'll lie. In fact, a nice little test for this is I'll say, do you feel good? Right, now, you know, if you hypnotize people and you say that normally, they just say yes.
Yes, exactly.
Right, so it's a nice soft little test. In fact, it was a kind of an accident the first time. I went, no, I feel horrible.
And you went, oh, great.
And then I basically ask them a series of very trivial questions. I'll say, how old are you? 72. How many kids you got? 84. What size feet have you got? 912.
It gets more and more absurd, right? More ridiculous.
The other thing you can do with the lying, in fact, I'll come to that in a moment. I will ask a series of trivial questions, normally four or five trivial questions, okay? I will then say, sleep. You're a truth teller. You can only speak the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth. Everything that comes out of your mouth will be the absolute truth. Nod your head when you understand. Eyes open, wide awake. You feeling good? Yeah. What's your name? Rob. How old are you? 28. How many kids you got? One. What's your biggest regret?
This is where it gets dicey, right?
That's it. that's the moment. That's when it happens, okay?
I can see it being very dramatic, but also you have to feature this very carefully.
I'm really not suggesting people ask that last question. I'm just trying to illustrate a principle here. I've had the opportunity to do this in kind of controlled environments where their girlfriend isn't there and their mum's not there.
That's very important, right?
And so on and so forth. And I tell you why. The first person I said this to, you this, you that, what size feet you got, how old are you? What's your biggest regret? Meeting Nicola. Who's Nicola? My fiance. Harsh. I appreciate that. And whether you've been having a bad week or whatever, that's what emerged. So that was like, ooh. I did it the next night. I won't say where it was because it's in case the person is listening. But I did it the next night. Bang. Same thing. Trivial question. Trivial question. Trivial question. Tell me something you've never told your mother. I'm bisexual.
Wow. Again, that would be a bit of a load on the table.
I was doing a casting for a rugby team, and all the guys were part of a rugby team. There wasn't an audience, apart from the three people I'd rejected. Everyone else was involved. There's a young guy there, liar, 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 truth, truth, truth. What's your biggest regret? Sleeping with that prostitute in Amsterdam.
Wow. Oh,
I did this. In fact, this will be featured. This is featured in full, in much more detail, on the new DVD, The Trilby Connection. I did it to a guy there and I said, what's your biggest regret? He looked stumped. He wasn't being evasive. He looked absolutely stumped. And I said, what's the biggest regret in your career? And this guy had actually had a very successful career in his line of work. As he was looking to kind of access, you know, well, you know, I didn't go for that interview. I just said, what's your PIN number? 1974. Thank you. All I can say is that every single time I've done this, I've had the opportunity afterwards to verify with the person that what they said to me was the truth. And it's just the way it's set up. It's just funny, lie, 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 truth, 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 bang. And it just spills. It just comes straight out of their mouth.
Use the same principle of dynamic tension because you're pushing them all the way one way, which is the lying route.
Yeah.
And on the bounce back, they end up telling you more truth than they would normally reveal because it's literally just a self-correcting mechanism at that point, right?
Yeah.
Now, something which is very interesting here, and just if anyone wants to try this routine, as Anthony rightly said, you know, be very careful where and how you present this because it can be very damaging. And I'm sure you've done something similar to this yourself. There's a lot of charming use that Erickson would do, who actually do very similar things to this, by the way. In public demonstrations in front of a bunch of doctors, he would get people to share very intimate details, but he'd add one little line, something along the lines of, you know, and we can be here on our own, and you can tell me about X, something you'd be happy to share with strangers, or something you'd be happy for other people to know about, right? So just that little line added to it, just softens it so that whatever they're saying, you know, they'll give you not necessarily their biggest regret, but you can say, what's one of your biggest regrets? So now they can select one which is, shall we say, socially more appropriate, won't get them fired, won't cause a blow up in the family, won't get them divorced or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, you can just do the liar routine. And in terms of routine, it's actually very easy.
It's powerful as well.
Yeah, it's powerful stuff. It's also very easy because on stage, you have a variability of kind of subjects and where they're at and what they're prepared to do. And it's very easy to lie and make up ridiculous lies. It's not actually that challenging. Obviously, if someone is hypnotized, I'd expect the lies just to emerge instantly and be driven unconsciously, if you like. So there's a way of flipping it around. You could say the truth and then you could do the lie. You can make that last question whatever you want it to be. Don't ask the, what's your biggest regret if you think it's going to ruin their life. Equally, I've had someone say, giving up the drums at 10. That was their biggest regret.
Which just means they probably had a pretty nice life. Because if your biggest regret is giving up the drums, wow.
It will come out. Now, just a couple more details on it. Obviously, when they're lying, you can get the truth out of them. Mm-hmm. Because you can say, it's just the way you phrase the question.
You just reverse the question, right? Like, you know, do you like X?
No, yeah, you don't like that. X. Yeah, you don't like that, do you? Oh. You don't, do you? Yeah, and so what you can do with the power of an edit is you can get a full-blown confession out of somebody. They'll have no idea why they're agreeing with you, but they'll find it that it's impossible to disagree. I also steal with this. I also steal things with this. So I just say, when they're lying, I say, they're not your sunglasses, are they? No. Oh, okay, I'll take them then. or you don't mind if I take them in, do you? No. There's lots and lots you can do with it. It's very, very simple.
The budding criminals listening right now, remember, this is all in fun and games. Everything is given back to the people in time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just keep your spirit positive here, right?
Yeah, totally. I was doing this in front of one of the most well-known hypnotherapists and NLP guys in Austria, and he'd seen a clip of this, and he was like, well, you couldn't get someone to confess to a murder using this. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, look, you're guessing. You know, exactly. I'm road testing this, and these are my results. This is what I'm saying. Every person I've said it to, even people who I haven't given amnesia to for the experience, have come up to me afterwards and said, I can't believe I said that. I mean, that's dangerous. I mean, you know.
Just to back up what you're saying there, I actually was talking to another hypnotist, friend of mine, who was actually recruited by, I think it was the South Korean government, to interrogate prisoners of wars. They actually had a general that they, I don't know how they got hold of him. And he did something similar, not quite the same as you were doing here, but you know, similar, inside an actual prison cell to get information from this person. Now, it's not 100% guaranteed in terms of, like, there are many dynamics you have to juggle at the same time, but it certainly is possible. There's a lot more possible than people will attest to, right?
Yeah, rather than thinking of this as, will someone just tell the truth if they're told to under hypnosis, to me, this is just about thinking around, well, how can I get someone to tell the truth?
Right.
And as I say, this...
You're thinking about how to create realities, basically.
Yeah, exactly. How can I create a situation where, you know, because this could happen... no one wants to use the word Freud, but this is almost like a Freudian slip. It's just a case of bang, 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 hit, bosh. Oh, and suddenly, you know, they've given it to you. So it's a good routine. It's a funny routine. I've asked people, what's the most expensive thing you've ever stolen? You know, and some people, it'll be a pair of socks. It'll be a sweet. It'll be, you know, 50 quid off my boyfriend. There's so many different things there. And at the end of the day, they can always write it off as, well, I was hypnotized and I was fantasizing. You know?
Anthony, this is a really powerful technique. In fact, it's a really powerful combination of this whole process. But, you know, we've kind of like run way over time in this
interview.
I don't mind, because this has been really good stuff, and I really want to thank you for sharing with us. I just want to make sure we cover, at least briefly in closing, the last stuff, the ending of the whole process, because we were talking about that before, so we can give people a full, full cycle before
let's
we finish up.
That. Okay, so let's just talk about the wake-up. Because of where I came from with this, and, you know, all the work began in the therapy room. I never used to count anybody out. It seemed like an opportunity missed, because I would use a sort of double bind at the end of the session that only as quickly as your unconscious knows and has made the changes and your conscious mind has accepted those changes will you drift back up to full and conscious wakeful alertness, something along those lines. And it's a nice little bind, a nice way to end a session. However, after training in stage hypnosis, learning a count out, which is kind of an easier way of finishing things on stage, it's now my preferred way of finishing things. Reason for that is that, one, I want to ensure we've had our fun, that everything is back to normal. So I'm going to use those kind of words. Everything will be back to normal. All the silly suggestions are gone. So I typically use a 1 to 5 count, and this is something that I suggest people learn. I learned this when I trained in stage hypnosis with John Chase years ago, and it's the one bit of his book. He's not big on scripts. It's the one bit of his book that he really scripts, and he just says, look, use this. It works. It covers everything. Although it's just ever so slightly different to that, it's pretty much a classic 1 to 5 count, okay? The reason I like it is that it wrenches the person from this nice, relaxed state into whoosh, into bang, wow, I'm back in the room. So I tend to end it with a big sort of hand clap, 5, eyes open wide awake, bang, clap of the hands, and they're very much back in the room. And again, for me, I may have suggested amnesia for the session, but basically that encourages amnesia if there's any truth.
It creates a very clear dividing line between the hypnotic experience and the quote-unquote normal experience, right?
Yeah, and I'm a big fan of the work of Ernest Rossi and the whole state-encoded memory thing, and I think it applies on this level as well. You've been in one particular state of mind when you were hypnotized, and now you're in an absolutely different state of mind. It's just like the doors close and, you know, you try and reflect on it and it's gone. So that's essentially it. I'm going to say something like this. In a moment, I'm going to count from 1 to 5. And on the count of 5, your eyes will be open. You'll be back in the room, full conscious, wakeful alertness, everything back to normal in every way. All the silly suggestions gone, feeling great. It'll be like you've woken up from a wonderful night's sleep. You'll understand hypnosis is not sleep, but the next time you get in bed and sleep, you'll sleep wonderfully. 1. Feeling less relaxed now, every muscle, nerve and fibre coming alive, that's right. 2, feel a surge of energy pouring in through your fingers, toes, up arms, legs, spine, neck to the top of your head. 3, take a deep breath, fill your chest up now, take a deep breath, energy giving oxygen whizzing around your system. 4, take another as your head is washed through with cool spring water, eyes clearing, chest clear, stomach clear. 5, eyes open, wide awake, back in the room. Very, very simple. Okay, but
perfect. And it captures all the main things. In other words, they make sure they sleep properly that night. You make sure that they come back without any feelings of nausea or trance hangovers. You make sure the suggestions are cleared. You make sure they have energy rather than feeling lethargic. So it leaves them basically in a good shape to get on with their day, right?
Yeah, the only thing I'd say there is you said that night. I will say the next time you get in bed to go to sleep. They might be working
nights. Correct. You're correct.
So it's a tiny refinement, but I kind of assume nothing, even with that little point. So
that is very true. That's a good point.
You'll understand hypnosis is not sleep, but the next time you get in bed and sleep, you will sleep wonderfully, that kind of thing. And again, it might vary a little bit, you know, like you've had a wonderful sleep, like you've had a massage, whatever it happens to be, but just ensure they feel good, ensure everything's back to normal. And then when they come out, I will typically just say, feeling good, and just lock them in with that question. I'll look at them. I genuinely want to hear it. Yeah, I feel great. Just do them a good service. Don't just disappear out the door. Ensure that this person's happy. And if they need any kind of explanation, then give them one. I'm big into teaching people kind of instant self-hypnosis, but that's for another day. They've entertained. Do them the good service. Give them what they deserve. Make sure they feel good. Do a proper wake-up. It's just so important.
Absolutely. And if nothing else, it just creates a really charming climax to the whole piece, right? They've done all these crazy things, it's now over, but even the coming over bit is like a rock concert with lots of energy and excitement and the lights flashing and everyone goes, yes, that's a proper ending. I've got closure on the whole experience now.
Yeah, and I will often, just as I'm queuing this up, I will look at the audience and say, in a moment when you wake up, to a huge round of applause from your friends.
Right.
Just point at them and make sure that that's going to come for being such a good sport, blah, 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 and then into the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it's nice and simple, okay? And I'll just say a few notes on the covert thing. Again, I won't go into too much detail. Quite a lot of what I do involves this kind of pre-show. So I set someone up with a post-hypnotic suggestion, and then later on, something amazing appears to happen quite spontaneously, but there's no sign of the hypnosis. There are various ways of doing it. You can essentially do the wake up when you set them up pre-show and say, and when that's done, everything will be back to normal. You can do the wake up as a post-hypnotic suggestion, if you like, because they're not back asleep when they're carrying out the post-hypnotic act, although in my opinion, they are very much in the same hypnotic place
exactly
as they were before. But you can also just take them to one side and do this. You can sometimes I will simply do it off mic. I'll just take someone aside and say, look, I just want to show you something. I'll just put them back in, tell them that we're going to do a proper wake up and it's going to make them feel really good, and I'll do it that way. Literally, I'll just hide it. I'll just do it somewhere else. Sometimes I'll get somebody else to do it. And if I'm going to get somebody else to do it, like if I'm doing a mixing this in with magic. I'll let the person know that someone else will be giving them a full and proper wake up, full attention later on. So there's various ways of doing it. But either way, all I'm saying is, although it might be unnecessary, although it might be kind of overkill, because you know, they're never asleep anyway, as much as anything, I just want to absolutely cover it. I want to make sure they feel good, because you've got to understand that people will pick up suggestions from others. And if that person went to 3 hypnosis shows and all their friends had headaches and they happened to tell them that, they'll probably come around with a headache unless you do something about it. So dictate how they're going to feel and do a good job. And that means finishing the job.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's just a belt and brace approach to make sure that there's no angle left uncovered so that the experience is a positive one for everyone concerned, right?
Absolutely. And, you know, by saying everything back to normal, well, there's a suggestion right there.
Yeah.
I guess they're going to take that suggestion.
And if you want to do it like very indirectly, I saw a great one from Erickson where he says you can wake up all over. And of course, the ambiguity, it's all over and so on. So it's just a nice little sidetrack. Anthony, you know what? I've got to say, first of all, thank you so much for spending extra time with us today to really give us the nuts and bolts of your system. Everyone listening, of course, you can realize that Anthony really knows his stuff and he knows it well. And, you know, there is plenty more where this came from. So I would encourage you to go and check out his DVD set. The Trilby Connection is basically everything we've talked about on DVD and then some. So you'll see more routines, more demonstrations, more things in actual action and so on. It's a phenomenal set. I know Anthony and he really does know his stuff. And, well, you can judge that for yourself because you've heard him speaking now, so it's a no-brainer. If you want to know more about that, just go to his website, www.headhacking.com. You can contact him via that or via anthonyjacquin.com as well. And Anthony, all I want to say is just virtually shake your hand, pat you on the back and say, wow, that was a very impressive interview. Thank you so much for sharing everything you've said and shared with us.
Well, thanks again, Igor. And if anyone is still listening after this many hours, you know, I appreciate you investing your time in listening to this. And as I say, if you have questions about anything that I've said, just feel free to get in touch. I'm very happy to answer your questions.
Awesome. Well, Anthony, thank you so much for taking part. I've been talking to Master Hypnotist Anthony Jacquin from headhacking.com. My name is Igor Ledóchowski from streethypnosis.com. And I will look forward to meeting all of you again on the next Interview with the Master.